You're listening to the Pagan Centered Podcast, bringing unique and intelligent perspective to the masses using contemporary technology, allowing for free discussion of one's personal beliefs and enlightenment of those not familiar with a particular religion. We bring to the forefront many issues that are ignored or shunned upon by mainstream religion. We discuss topics on a religious and non-religious level as they relate to our panel representing varied belief systems. Our brute honesty and candid opinion has made us one of the longest-running and most popular pagan podcasts. Feel welcome to call in live or submit listener feedback via our website, pagancenteredpodcast.com.
Welcome to this episode of PCP, the Pagan Centered Podcast. I'm Amber.
I'm Sam.
And also joining us tonight are
Kara.
Stereo.
I'm Peter.
Miles.
Snooze.
I'm Star.
The mistress of tangents. I'm sorry.
And tonight we are talking about how to wreck a pagan community that has been kindly donated as a topic by Miles. So we'll talk.
Well, I didn't actually donate the pagan community.
Well, no, but you had enough to donate the topic.
The concept, which
kind of tax break can you get on that?
An awfully big one.
Don't know. Actually, this concept first began. And I was talking to her and friends at Pagan Pride Day in North Carolina last year. It was initially...
It's your fault.
It's all your fault. No, it's okay. But the workshop that I hosted there was about ways and means of making a working pagan community. And it occurred to me afterwards that there are as many ways to disable one as there are to make one. And I thought that is like a worthy topic all by itself. So I throw up an outline and Kofi liked it, and so here we are. I'll try again, I'm sorry. Well, we can talk about how to wreck a pagan community. You need to know what constitutes a community and how to make a good one, especially for pagans. There are many different kinds of communities out there. If it's just a group of people with some kind of a shared interest. It might be communities of people with something in common that need each other as a support network, or just people who have common interests. But the communities that pagans most often find themselves in are communities of a localized and faith-based nature, which might be a group of coffins working in accord, or maybe an online community, or just a bunch of people who don't want to call themselves a coven yet, but just want to hang out all together. for a pagan community to be a vested and working entity, there's a few rules that I should all follow. Community members will observe some form of mutual respect and tolerance for each other's faiths and beliefs and interests. They should all agree to work towards a common goal, if that's planting a ritual or planning a group trip or arranging movie outings and whatnot. I've learned that one thing that I'm saying coven to do well is if they all have one's centralized location to meet at, like if everyone meets at one person's house, or if they can arrange events at a local New Year church or whatever. And as the community grows, they develop a community presence. And if the reputation spreads about them and they become more well known, and it benefits everybody. If the community has a positive reputation, so there's lots of elements involved in making one work, but there's also as many ways of making one work as there are of making one not work. My voice is for crap today, guys. I'm really sorry about this.
But okay, it happens. Everything will be out perfect when it comes to post-production.
Yeah,
hey, gorgeous. Just do you some Rugen. All you gotta do is whip out the Rugen.
Yeah.
Slow down and give me some count.
So.
Thank you.
I agree that, there are a lot of very easy ways to make a community work.
Viable. Yeah.
Yeah, but, and I'm probably going off on a tangent here. I'm kind of curious as we talk about this on why people don't always sit down and take a look at these things when they run into issues. Because it seems to me like the things that make them wreck is just sort of people not recognizing what makes things work sometimes.
Wait, elaborate that again? For some reason, I just missed it completely.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm already on it.
Well, I mean, the things that wreck a community, it seems to me that the communities fall apart sometimes because they don't understand what makes things work. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you recognize the things that make communities work, then you're more likely to be able to prevent the things that tear them apart. Am I making sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Friend of mine and I the other day, and it was was simply put and summed up in one sentence. Just because I don't agree with you right now doesn't mean I don't like you.
Exactly. That's a biggie right there.
I mean, I'll be honest with you. I love disagreeing with my friends. Well, kind of sort of. Okay, I mean, we both hone each other's perspective. Sometimes I'm the changed man. Sometimes it's the other person's. I'm stubborn, but hey, let's not go there. He's going to disagree with me.
See, I wonder if it's people understanding what makes community or people just not understanding boundaries at all. Because it seems like a lot of what people bring into a community and then it starts chaos and that kind of stuff is completely not understanding boundaries and customs and that type of thing at all. And I'm wondering if you educate them about what makes the community, will they give a shit?
I think you're dead on with some of that.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, I hate to be all...
Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. I hate to be all Southern, but to me, it's sort of all... It kind of boils down to manners, you know? And some people just ain't got them.
I think you're right there, too, and I'm gonna do the kick in the Southern because... I find that it's a different kind of perception of manners. I think that too many times people look at community as if it should be a group of really, really close friends, and down here that means you never for a lot of people, that means you should never, ever disagree with each other or say anything, you know, that's not pleasant. And I think instead people should look at community as a professional-ish, more like a workplace dynamic. As Scurvy said just a few minutes ago, he doesn't have to agree with you to like you, but he doesn't have to like you. You know, it can go both ways, and I think people make it too personal.
Well, here's the thing. Do you have to like people to be in community with them? I don't think you do. I think you can function in a community setting without liking everyone, and I think that's also one of the things, because people think, oh, well, I have to like them, or that type of thing, or I don't like this person, therefore I'm going to act this way towards them, because really I want to push them out of community.
Exactly. I don't think you have to like everyone to be in community with them, but that's why I said I think people should take it more as being like a workplace type thing sometimes. There's sometimes when you have to be in community with someone and you just have to sort of agree to disagree and agree to not engage on a personal level.
You know, I talk about this to myself mainly when I'm alone, but I see community.
Star, you're not supposed to admit that.
I know. I see... Okay.
Remake it so we can get a Mr. Peter back here.
Okay.
Okay.
Hey, I exist.
Awesome. I think.
Okay. Well done, Scurvy. We're still missing people.
Who are we missing?
Well, they just haven't picked up. Oh, wow.
I'm on. I made it.
Wow. Scurvy, you just, like, called the herd. What the hell? There's an Amber.
Okay.
And a Miles.
Hello. What did they do?
Barrett in the snooze. Yay! We've almost got Barrett.
And the audio is really choppy.
That is.
Interesting.
Ooh.
Holy crap.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's call everybody back. So everybody hang up.
Okay.
All right.
That's much better.
This sounds better.
Okay. I can hear.
All right.
Scurvy's has a call failed thing going on there. Okay.
Still me.
There he goes.
Wow.
Here was an example of a community activity. We were all good.
See that?
And we all had a vested interest.
Yeah.
We had mutual expect for everything except the software.
And the technology.
Hi, I'm Peter, and this is version C of the Pagan Centered Podcast. Join us and see if we can go through the alphabet tonight.
I need one of those, like, clipboards from the movies. Take six. Click.
That's right.
So I think of community as being, like, a series of concentric circles. And, like, what's appropriate for, like, my individual group, my coven, is different than the standards and the set of manners and stuff I use for, like, the wider community. So, like, when I'm talking about, like, the greater pagan community, there's a lot more leeway and inclusiveness than there would be in my little local group that gets together, you know, once or twice a month. So I think there's different levels of that there. But, you know, if you hold the wider community, the people that you interact with at a distance, people who aren't part of your you know, intimate worship group, if you're playing, you know, who gets in and who gets out on like a regional scale or on a national scale, that I think gets to be a little bit ridiculous. I mean, unless someone's just proven themselves to be, a complete embarrassment, I think that,
I think that's where some confusion comes in, because you know who belongs to a community because they conform to your norms. The larger the group, the fewer norms that there actually are. You know, it's more loose. The tighter the circle, the more social norming that you have going on, and the more that people are pushed to conform to those norms. And I think what happens is people get in these small groups, and pagans really do this, because a lot of times people are in small groups, covens, that type of thing, and they have these pretty tight little norms. Everyone knows how to interact and what's expected. And then we get into these larger groups, and everyone's like, why are you acting that way? This is wrong. I don't understand why you're not fitting in. And we're looking at our small group social norms, and we're expecting people to do that on a much larger, looser community level.
Yeah, I mean, and Snooze can probably have seen this before, too, is even with the native community, we'll see a lot of that is, you know, you'll have the little powwow groups, the little groups that go around together, and then once you get to the big ones, it's who is involved, who isn't involved, and who is allowed to be in your group, and there's so much animosity from, are you recognized, are you not recognized, are you state recognized, are you federally recognized, are you half blood, full blood, quarter blood, and whereas that deals with more physical things, it's still, when it comes to acceptance, can cause this huge problem. And with paganism, I mean, you do have the people that, oh, well, I have it in my family, it goes this far back, I come from this country. But even if it goes to what they do for ritual, or what they wear for ritual, or how they cast circle, and once it gets to the bigger community, it gets harder and harder to find something that will work for everybody. And it seems like they're more concerned with the little details and making sure everybody follows the little details than dumbing down their own details in order to fit in with the larger group.
You know, that makes a lot of sense because I've met people who have like these amazing pedigrees that there's no way on earth that I would ever circle with them. And I think there's a lot of the whole external details rather than your personal character that people tend to grab onto. You know, I mean, for me to say that, you know, if you don't eat grits for breakfast, you're not an American, that's kind of silly. You know, and a lot of that is, you know, if you don't have this X thing, that's just for the circumstance in your life, or you know, something that has nothing to do with what the issue at hand is, then you're not welcome into this community, and that's kind of silly.
I can ID or echo what Anne had said on that. And, you know, what you're talking about, even though they're necessarily the same thing, I do think that actually
Snooze's audio just left.
Oh, good.
Well, here's just an observation about this. Community has the ability to exert peer pressure. Once community starts getting to the point where members in it are immune to the effects, are we still broadcasting?
Yes.
That's okay.
But once the community gets to the point where members of it are immune to the effects of peer pressure, then we got problems.
Well, peer pressure is going to be found even in groups of five people. Sometimes it's a good thing, sometimes it's a bad thing, and I think that's going to be something that we're just going to all have to accept and work through. Like, I think that's human nature.
Yeah, peer pressure, if everybody wants to jump off the bridge except the one guy that's not succumbing to peer pressure, is not necessarily a good thing. More than peer pressure, as a way to make sure that everybody is on the same page. I don't even really care if everybody's on the same page as long as they're not trying to rip the pages out of each other's hands. And that might be going a little too metaphor, but it, again, what we were talking about earlier about not necessarily having to like people to agree with them, or just because you disagreed, you know, doesn't mean that you don't like them or you don't respect their opinion. I think the big thing is looking at someone and saying, just because I don't agree with you doesn't mean I don't respect you or respect that you still might have something to say, even if it's not for me.
Yeah, and I think that's really hard. I was having a conversation with my boss, and we were talking about understanding people and things like that, and she made a comment that kind of hit me funny, was that most people are afraid of losing themselves in the process of understanding somebody else and respecting somebody else, even though they're different. So that it's actually a very rare thing to find somebody that will truly put themselves aside in order to look at somebody else and go, yeah, I really can understand where you're coming from. And even though they don't have to agree, that they're comfortable enough to understand that and move past it and accept the person for who they are. And I thought that was really fitting, but it was also kind of disheartening in a way.
Well, you get... There's a trend in dealing with compromise that I'm seeing all over now, not just in the pagan community, but of course it affects it. There seems to, is it just me, or is there a growing trend that compromise is akin to a loss of personal integrity or some lack of character, as opposed to actually being a mark of personal strength?
My will is the most important thing in the universe, Snooze.
Exactly. Wait, back up. So's mine.
I'll bow down to Star.
Oh, so worship me and despair.
My hat is taller and blacker and poorer than yours. Therefore,
and they're also important than all you. What's?
I'm sorry.
Okay, Sam's in the water, Nixie.
Are you done,
Sam? You know, there's definitely a fine balance between groupthink and group minds and be the mighty thing in the universe. Community got to be give and take there. And as long as it's a healthy, you know, sort of give and take, then that's good.
I think there's the flip side to that too. And there's so many difficult things about being trying to do any type of leadership position in the pagan community. And there's the old cliche about herding cats, but gods know it's true. Mm-hmm. There's the fact that a lot of the reason that people can gravitate toward the pagan community is because they don't like a lot of authoritarianism. They don't necessarily want a centralized authority or a hierarchy. But you kind of got to get a common organizational point somewhere. Side of the not ever listening to someone else, where we were talking about a minute ago about putting yourself aside and absorbing that other person's position, is that I've seen people eat pagan leaders alive because the pagan leader had that talent and had that gift, but didn't know when to put it on pause or put it on hold and say, okay, this is as far as it goes and no more up to this point. I have to maintain my own balance. I have to see to myself.
This is true.
So everybody just needs to get really good at juggling.
Forget the balance. Throw that out. Juggle instead.
There you go.
Someone like Peter, who may have had some experience?
Someone's on the
and
spot.
And whom we can put on the spot?
Oh, look at me. I'm fabulous
for you. It's like a metaphysical spotlight on Peter now, over the Virgin Islands.
No pressure or anything.
Paging Peter Diving. Mr. Diving.
Hello, please, no pressure at all.
Oh, you're welcome.
Yeah, what I'm going to do is I'm going to relate a conversation I had with you with Patrick McCollum a couple days ago, and he was talking about having been over in Asia, and they named him something or another, and much to his surprise, all of a sudden 50,000 people have back when he walks by.
Oh, wow.
And he says he comes back to the United States, and, you know, he has to edit the word leader out of his language because pagans just aren't okay with that. And in a way, I think part of it is we have this idea of leadership that comes from the Catholic Church and patriarchy and everything else. And I've been kind of promoting the idea of pagan super servants rather than leaders, is that that's really what our leadership is. They're super servants to the community rather than people who establish a direction. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And I think that's a good way to, you know, not get as many bites taken out of your butt. Not that I haven't had a few taken out today. I have, but... You know, it's just a lot easier to kind of try to facilitate, create direction.
Why were people biting on you today?
I've been involved in...
Nothing better to do.
I mean, you know, you've been doing really shitty things like raising funds for people who are, like, completely fucked in Japan. So I can see why people would say, oh, you suck. But, okay, you got to explain that to me because I don't get it.
You get jumped on by the Pearl Harbor crowd.
No, nothing quite that bad. It's more people with, you know, legitimate questions about the legitimacy of what I'm doing or the organization that we've chose or the people that are endorsing it who just really don't have the skills to phrase them as legitimate questions, if that makes sense. They're very confrontational. Okay. So there's a lot of...
Playing
moderator.
Yeah, we got one of those that showed up in the list. Yeah, she was adamant that because the organization's domain doesn't end in .org, that it can't possibly be a reputable charity and it should be reported to the FBI.
Wow.
Yeah. Cool. I like the guys from the FBI. They're fun when they come around.
You know,
they got cool tech to play with.
Yeah.
Unlike the, you know, dealing with leaders thing, you know, I'm training in Tradcraft and we'll be up for initiation this summer, which is terrifying. And
clapping.
Yeah, and you know, I have leaders. I have a priest and a priestess that I answer to, but you know, it's not like, you know, they tell me how to think or how my own soul is in relation to the cosmos, although they can guide me in that stuff. You know, the kind of leadership they provide is they start things on time. And, you know, I say this all the time. They tell me to bring potato salad and where to put the potato salad when I get there. And, you know, they do a lot of leadership that doesn't have a whole lot to do with, you know, I am so wise and wonderful and more amazing than you are. They have a lot more leadership to do with facilitating spiritual growth and community fellowship. So to me, the whole concept of leadership isn't, you know, some high muckety muck, you know, in velvet robes looking down their nose, you know, at all the small people. So right. I don't get that whole image, the whole issue with leadership. I mean, you know, I tell people I feel kind of smug because, you know, I hear people talk about, you know, oh, our rituals never start on time, or, you know, we never know what people are bringing for feast, or, you know, they have these issues, and I'm like, yeah, we don't have that, but, you know, then we sort of recognize that we have leaders, and, you know, we support them in that, and, yeah, don't know what to tell you.
No, I absolutely agree with you on that, and I think you've hit it on the head. Instead of looking at a leader as a high muckety muck, God forbid, you're looking at them as a facilitator and an organizer and the person who just happens to know what's going on and where everybody's phone number is. At risk of probably pissing off somebody for the reference, but I'm going to pull it up because the word is good. The original word in biblical hierarchy for what now gets translated as a deacon is diakonos, which my understanding is has always been it translates as servant overseer, not necessarily somebody who just goes around bossing everyone around, but the person who stands in the middle and coordinates what's going on in the corners because he can see all of the corners and is likely to get run over by anyone running from one to the other.
A spiritual foreman.
Something like that, yeah. Just it's organizational more than it is thou shalt go here and you get your butt over there and bow when I tell you to. It's organizational skills, and part of being a good leader is knowing where your skill set ends and finding people whose skill set is better in that area than yours is and putting them all together.
Right, and you know, that doesn't preclude having like spiritual insight and spiritual wisdom and spiritual knowledge, because I do look to my priest and priestess for that. But you know, I think a lot of people think that just because you know a lot about the craft or you know a lot about occultism or stuff like that, that you should be a leader. But you know, if you don't have leadership skills, then you know, nobody is going to follow you. I know instances where people have thought that for whatever reason, that they should be a leader, and, you know, so they make a, you know, sort of a grand stand, but they didn't have the skills, and then they were kind of surprised to find that nobody was following them.
Yeah. Is there a goal that everyone's being led to? Is leading, I think, is the purpose of wanting to lead because you want to have the ego trip of being looked up to, or is the purpose of leading in that you want to help everyone else get somewhere good too?
I like that one.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's true. The thing that we're also doing a lot of is we're really good in community about in covens and local organizations because we have this human contact with one another, kind of leaders emerge and they're very respected. But as we grow into larger and larger pagan organizations, that sometimes the leaders are people that you've never met in person, that all you know is their name or all you see is, you know, posts online or things in newsletters and stuff. And it's then becomes very easy to project your own issues on those people who you've never known. And I think that's truly one of the problems in the community is local leaders are pretty highly respected, but people kind of get a little suspicious when anybody moves on that past that level.
Well, and I think as a group, pagans tend to be more suspicious of, you know, anyone in a position where they think that they might have power over, even if they aren't using it that way or they have no intention of doing that. And I think that suspicion makes them see it even when it isn't there.
Yeah, I think we're the only people still fighting the man, even if the man's not actually there.
Oh, my God.
We're still like, we're fighting the man.
That's the man. That's the man.
What's pretty funny about this is, you know, it's well known in pagan organizations that the way to get into a leadership position is not to be in the room when the vote is taken.
So. Right.
Yeah.
No joke.
That happens for more than just pagan leadership organizations, trust me.
Yeah,
I'm sure.
Yep. There's other ways to get drafted to be a leader. One.
Yeah, you can answer your phone.
That too.
That was my problem.
Number two is you can just be capable of doing the job and job needs done badly. That happens.
Right.
Three, you get a couple of confused people come up to you, say, hey, I need some help with this, and four or five other people see it, and yeah, that one snowballs too. But that's a problem with that one, though, because then later on, once you get people organized, and someone says, well, I want to assume leadership, they'll just go and they'll wrestle it away from you, which I think is a good thing, really, but then things just sort of turn to shit.
I think in general there's a lot of people that, you know, I was actually having a discussion with somebody because they said that a spiritual leader will tell you what you want to hear, whereas a teacher will tell you what you need, or something similar to that. I was like, you know what, there are a lot of people who claim to be spiritual leaders that will tell you what they think you want to hear because they want your money or they want your attention. But really, it's nothing like that at all. You know, a good spiritual leader will push you to be self-confident and be self-critical and, you know, all of these things that are important for your journey in life, no matter if you stay there or if you go somewhere else. But there are also a large amount of people who don't want to think. So they will take somebody that, like Scurvy was saying, gives help to somebody else and answers questions, and they will latch on to that person and view them as a leader because they have good answers.
Well, you know, another thing is, you know, if you are in a leadership position and you are not occasionally pissing people off, then you're probably not doing your job, because that's just sort of part and parcel of it. You can't please everybody and maintain a viable community.
That is a fact.
One of the quotes I use a lot when I used to run my group was that a person who tries to please everybody will end up pleasing nobody. And so I used to always just try and choose what seemed like the most rational choice for the group as a whole. If one or two people feel left out of it, they'll get over it.
You know, many people are talking about leadership within our community, but they're talking about them as spiritual leaders. But we have a lot of leaders who are emerging who are not leaders within their tradition or their religion, yet they're leaders, and they're emerging as leaders. Also, we have people who, yes, they may be a leader within their religion, but they're taking a leadership position outside of their religion. And yes, Peter, just like you, damn it. because, like, really, I am not part of Peter's tradition, and no offense to COG, but, like, you know, I don't really pay attention to COG because it's nothing to do with me, really. Yet, I appreciate his leadership within the larger community. So I think a lot of times we get a little too attached to the thought that it needs to be a spiritual leader. You know, they're a leader within their spiritual group in order to be a leader within a religion, and I don't think that that's true. I think a little separation sometimes is a good thing.
Get out of my brain, because I'm just sitting here thinking about, you know, that, I mean, people are often, you know, oh, you know, you're in this position, you must be a spiritual leader. I'm like, who, me? I struggle with my path. What are you talking about? And I think there's somewhere we got the idea that spiritual and leader should go together, when it's really spiritual teacher, and a leader can be a totally separate thing. You know,
that's
leaders
that skill set thing, yeah.
They do logistics like I do. Yeah. They do organizing. You know, I'm not the person somebody needs to come to for spiritual leadership. I have lots of friends who are, who I go to and depend on. But I just don't think that the two things, while they're entwined in our language, I'm not sure that's appropriate for our community. Because I'm not really sure that our spiritual leaders should be spending time making sure where everybody's phone number is. I think maybe they should be spending time dealing with people.
That's a skill set specialization thing I was talking about a while ago. That's, to me, that it's no insult for someone to say, this is where, you know, this is where my skills are at. I'm good organizing here. This person over here, however, is the person you need to talk to about where you're at on the spiritual level. And it doesn't necessarily mean that one person has to be at the top of the pyramid and everyone else comes under them. I mean, again, look at it as a workplace thing. You have different departments for different specializations or different concentrations.
But, you know, one really good example, and he's not here, so I feel free to talk about him, is, you know, Jason's sort of in the same boat as me. He's a student in a tradition, but, you know, he runs the Wild Hunt, and he's started up the PNC, and he's very knowledgeable about the greater pagan community and paganism in general, and how media works, and about how pagan news works. So he's a leader, but he's not a spiritual leader. And that's, I think that's a powerful thing, because I think he's sort of, you know, a big example of how we can serve our communities and how we can show leadership in our communities without necessarily running out and becoming the high muckety muck of, you know, Starhawk, Moon, Grove Circle, West.
I'm going to repeat some words that I hear a lot right before I begin seeing trouble. Well, if he can, why can't I?
Hey, y'all,
watch
this.
You do a good job at it. Yeah, if you do a good job at it, why not?
So here's and on the topic of community and leadership and all that, everybody's a leader.
Oh, yeah, we are.
Oh, yeah, we are.
But.
Echo.
Echo.
Oh, good.
But the problem with that
is a pagan... There's a pagan church nearby that has written into their church charter that the church chancellor and the high priest must not be the same person. It has to be two separate roles held by two separate people. Otherwise, it becomes too much of a monopoly.
And, you know, even in a lot of Native things, a lot of people will point and go, oh, well, this chief, what they don't realize is they had a chief for each little clan, and then they had an elected full chief, and then they had war chiefs and peacetime chiefs. So it wasn't just one guy running the whole thing. They had many people in charge for different skill sets. So
it's a council.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They knew that one guy was very good at, you know, like Peter was touching on, he does strategy and working things together and making sure everything is organized. You know, they had one person that was exceptional at that, and that is what he did. But when it came to getting somebody to understand visions, no, he sent them somebody else. And I think that the key thing is they all felt comfortable, no matter if it was Native or anywhere else. You have to feel comfortable in saying, this is not my cup of tea. Here, go over here. This person yeah. can mm-hmm. teach you better than I can. And I think that's another place where people tend to screw up, not only with everybody assuming that because you are a leader, you can do the same thing, even if you look with medicine, something as simple as medicine. You have neurologists and psychologists and surgeons mm-hmm. and pediatricians, but right. they're all doctors. You could have several different leaders that all have different skill sets. We need to stop assuming that they're all the same, and at the same time, we need the people that are leaders to step back when need be and be willing to share the burden with somebody else who's more specified.
You know, my chat has confused people before because our public information officer mm-hmm. and the person who does outreach is not the high priestess of our tradition. And she doesn't lead every ritual. And she doesn't teach most of the classes. Like, there's a totally different, separate group of people who teach classes. And, like, everything is delegated to the point that, you know, there have actually been people who have said, well, maybe she's not actually the leader of the tradition. It's like, well, no, she just delegates really well because that's how we all stay sane. And it's cool, too, because it fosters more leadership within our tradition, because people get the opportunity to teach classes and do public outreach and lead ritual without having to take on the mantle of being the high muckety muck figurehead.
I have two thoughts. First thought is that this need for a council of specialized, if you want, hub leaders, and the recognition that we can't all be good at everything is why we also find ourselves as polytheists and not monotheists. But other thought was that in a council of many voices, there's sometimes the risk of one of the councils saying that he has a clearer vision of where the group as a whole should be going than somebody else on the council, which can sometimes lead to ego clashes within the council.
You know, where he's going is a logical progression of what we're talking about. Is if everybody's a leader, then we're really talking about what makes somebody a good community member? I mean, how do they contribute yeah. and do their little piece of leadership, their little piece of whatever it is they do, and contribute to the whole?
Team player.
I think that's one of those, I hate to keep going back to a business management thing, but that everybody having a chance maybe to try some leadership skills or try stepping in. Part of being a good community member is that kind of cross-training, being aware of what the people that are in that position a lot go through and being willing to say, okay, I'm over here doing this thing. I may not be able to see what everybody over there is doing, what everybody over there is doing, but I understand that where this person is standing, they can. So what I need to do is make sure as long as I'm communicating good with him, well with him, then the boat's going to stay afloat.
And somebody had just put in the chat room that what makes somebody a good community member is somebody who is willing to be of service to others in the community.
Yep.
Yay!
I agree with that, cool. But there's also, I mean, I think we have ideas over what makes a good community member. I mean, what are some of those things? I mean, because you can say a general thing like someone being willing to serve others, but what does that look like?
You know,
to serve others, let me think about this. Maybe showing up first when you got to do something. Maybe going out of your way to actually know what you need to do.
Calling tables, setting up food, washing the dishes.
Okay, there we
right.
Go.
My little local group, you know, our feeling is, you know, if you show up for like right on time for ritual, right after ritual, but you don't ever show up for one of the club days or one of the work days, you're in the community work, you know. You have community. Say, by our deeds, you know.
Okay, so I mean, but we're thank you help. Forgiveness. You know, it's very blunt. I mean, what else that makes a good community member?
I think some come down to respect of the members, because when you respect the members, then you're doing something not for the recognition of, oh, I helped out, look at me, I deserve a cookie, but you're doing it because you don't want somebody else to do all the work. You're helping because they are their family who deserve your time and consideration rather than doing it for recognition. And it's even if you don't have the ability to do something, you're willing to spend time, you're willing to talk, you're willing to, because you want to help take the burden off of those other people. If you look at relationships, I was told a wonderful piece of advice that when you're in a intimate relationship, the only thing that matters is that other person. And whereas it sounds silly, if you keep that in your mind and the other person keeps that in your mind, their mind, it all balances out to where you're both looking out for each other. If everybody in the community does that, it's not going to be a one-sided somebody gets all the cookies. It's everybody will look out for each other and make it a beautiful juggling act just by doing that.
Another thought that comes to mind, is kind of making comparisons lately between coven witchcraft and congregational witchcraft. Congregational witchcraft is an evolution, naturally on the Christian church, where the congregation comes to the church on Sundays when service begins. They all file in and sit down in the pews there for the service, and they all leave. And that's all they do. They come in to hear the prayers and to receive God's grace, and they all go home. Whereas in coven witchcraft, everyone works and gather with equal shares in making it all fly. And I think that some of the less team-oriented participants in congregational still see it as, I'll go there, I'll be in circle, I'll play a chant, I'll drink a mead, and I'll leave, and that's all I have to do, that's all my participation entails. They aren't aware that there's more to it in taking a ritual and the day and the use of the event place where it's being held goes on well. So someone either has to tell them that yes, you came for ritual and that's good, but please hang around as well to help us clean the floors, or else somebody just has to realize that there will be some people who just want to be there to be in ritual, and then they think that their part is done. You can't teach some people that there's more to it than that.
You know, I want to comment for just a second on the idea of people who are helpful as in far as like grunt work, but then have really bad attitudes. You know, to be all witchy for a second, you know, intent is huge. And, you know, if you come and you bring a pie and you have a really bad attitude, I'm not interested in your pie. I've actually, I have actually, when people who have come to ritual and, you know, they make a big deal about, you know, they've brought, you know, a casserole or something, but then they have this really divisive, sort of shit-stirring attitude, you know, I don't eat their casserole. That's negativity. I don't appreciate mm-hmm. the casserole, they, you know, that's because true. it's imbued with their intent. So that's kind of how I view that. You know, I mean, I know someone. They're a really awesome couple, and one of the ladies is the family chef, and everything she makes apparently like gets imbued with whatever mood she's in. So when she's in a good mood, like you eat her food and you feel amazing. And she came home one day and she was in a really bad mood, and she made a casserole and went and told her partner and the kids that, you know, I made dinner, it's on the counter. And her partner and the kids went in there, and they looked at it, and they smelled it. They said it looked wonderful, but they weren't going to eat it. And they couldn't even get the dog to eat it, even though it smelled amazing. So, like,
that
you know,
was a
I
really
mean,
corny movie with Sarah Michelle Gellar. I can't think of the name of it now. Oh, God. I got to look that up. I'm sorry. Hey, I'm sorry. I am a Buffy fan for multiple reasons, and I'll fight anybody over it, but that's another story.
Oh my God.
No, it's the premise of the movie, though. It was a very corny movie, but it's exactly what she's talking about. The chick was working magic when she was a professional chef that was opening a catering place, and she was working magic every time she cooked, and it was affecting the entire neighborhood and eventually the whole city.
You know, to continue with your tangent, there's a Mexican movie, too. What the hell is it called? I think it's like Water for Chocolate, where
yeah,
every time
yeah,
this
yeah,
woman
yeah,
cooks,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah, whatever she's mm-hmm. feeling goes into the food, and yeah.
Yeah.
All right, cool movie. All right, in tangent.
It's cool. A good illustration of how sympathetic or intentional magic works for someone who has no clue what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm. I think another thing that... and Kara touched on it in the chat, is that if being a good community member can sometimes mean holding your tongue in public when somebody says something that's offensive, whether it is at a public gathering or whether it is on a public forum or even something like a personal Facebook post, it can mean contacting a person one-on-one instead of telling them how much you hate their idea and so on and so forth and how they are a horrible person right on the front of their page. Or right on the front
Amber,
of their blog.
What fun are you?
You know, I want to say, though, if someone has made whatever ill decision that they've engaged in extremely public, you know, at that point, it's, you know, if they've already made all of that public, it's not necessary to go to them one-on-one.
True.
That's my opinion. If someone blows up the Empire State Building, you don't have to go and ask their permission to write about them.
True. Mm-hmm. You know, but
it still remains that it's a good point that it's smart to hold your tongue sometimes when somebody publicly says something that's ill-considered, because, I mean, often those people, as a result of that and seeing that, you know, you kind of don't participate in it, kind of back off and come back with a more reasonable approach. We saw this recently with Pantheon. There were a number of people who were very wound up on different sides of an issue, and about 2 or 3 weeks later, when people didn't respond to their kind of over-the-top opinions, they started posting and talking in a very reasonable way about, you know, accommodation and making room for people and stuff. And sometimes it's just, if you hold your tongue, they'll figure it out.
Mm-hmm. Or sometimes, you know, you really just look like an idiot posting things that full of anger. Sometimes you need to step back and watch your tongue, and so you look good for... I don't want to say so you're politically correct, because that's not what I'm trying for, but it's more of if you just use verbal vomit, it looks bad on not only you, but the rest of the people that your community is trying to put a good foot forward. You know?
Well, yeah, that's why I refuse to be part of any community. That would be why I refuse to be part of any community.
Oh, we would never know anybody who would use massive quantities of emo vomit to make some non-existent point.
No.
You know, another thing, too, is, you know, if someone has, you know, made a huge public gaffe or whatever, you know, sometimes that's their lesson that they have to learn, and you have to step back. And, you know, but, you know, it's hard, too. You know, if this is somebody who's part of your community, you know, like, you know, if someone were to start going around and saying that, you know, my coven, you know, juggles kittens, you know, like, maniacally, like Steve Martin, you know, that would be something that, you know, I would have to step up and be like, no, we don't actually juggle kittens. That's kind of cruel. The kittens don't like it very much. That's not part of what we do. So there's that whole thing of you have that tension between this is a lesson that they have to learn, and you know, you have to also think about correcting, like, misinformation and stuff about your community. So, yeah.
I think your point's well taken, Star, but I also think if you tell them that the kittens don't like it very much, they might not believe you.
Actually, if you told me that the kittens don't like it very much, I'll pretty much assume you tried it at least once.
Yeah, that's a good point.
That's how you know they resisted.
I know somebody who accidentally outed himself for a bi experience that way. I can't remember exactly how the question was asked, but he responded some to... It was in a very self-incriminating manner. Now, in a homophobic community, that's pretty detrimental.
And there are also times...
I was waiting for a bad livestock joke there.
Not to say it, but I didn't want to make editable material.
Ask me later about Pepper the Appaloosa.
Uh-oh.
No, I didn't do that.
You know, there's a really good point in the show notes that I'd like to bring up, and it's the idea of having... One of the things that makes a community strong is having some sort of, like, material presence. And one thing that we've seen a lot lately is a lot of groups are starting to build temples and create sacred space and invest in real estate and structures and infrastructure.
Having
you know,
a real landed physical presence.
Yeah, I mean, that's powerful. I mean, I know groups who they put it as they used to indulge in guerrilla witchcraft, where they would they literally had like a Tupperware thing that was full of all of their altar tools, and they would go to a state park, they'd turn the Tupperware thing over, use it as the altar, set up their stuff, do their ritual, and then they would pack it all back up in the Tupperware thing and go home. And you know, it was
called
a big
Porta Pagan.
Yeah, we got a vendor down here that puts those together and calls them quickie altars or instant altars.
Yeah, it's all in one metal box.
Altar wherever you go. Yeah,
that's right. In boxes the altar, and then it's got the family and the chalice, everything else you need, and you go to a ritual place. Come in the box, it all goes on the lids, and pass the altar off. You go have the ritual, and then after you're done, it's as if they were never there. You know,
leave no trace.
Yeah.
Take only pictures, leave only footprints.
Yeah, well, they were saying
there is something to be said for that, for the material presence you're talking about, though, because it's, again, while we've noted several times that pagans kind of tend to stay away from a lot of heavy structure, especially with authority attached to it. If you don't have some structure, you got to find a fine line somewhere between structure and freedom. And again, I could touch back on that being part of being a good community member. As being someone who's willing to try to find a balance there that might be outside of their comfort zone.
This is such a positive group. I was so hopeful about this episode of How to Wreck Something. Here we're talking about how to fix it all.
Well, we're noting stuff that has worked, so everything else is stuff that hasn't worked.
But if it'll make scurvy feel better, I'll get all ranty for a second.
Go for it.
So some of the things that will wreck
the house.
A community, from personal experience and experiences I've had, is when you don't respect people's time. When you tell people ritual will start when it starts, and they just need to show up whenever, and it will be done when it's done, and that, you know, their wife or their children or whatsoever just need to be flexible and understanding. You know, so if you don't respect people's time, that's a huge, huge issue. If you don't respect people's intelligence, if you tell people that what you were teaching is X or what you were doing is X and it's not X, and you get really upset and defensive when, you know, they call you on it, that's going to destroy community because it destroys credibility. Let me think. If you expect people to go out of their way to do things for the community, to go out of their way to invest into the community, and you don't acknowledge that, you know, if you don't acknowledge people's contributions, then that's a pretty big deal. And if you don't make people's if you're not clear about the expectations going into a community, what the community is about, what the goals are, and what ways they can participate in the community, and what paths they can take towards leadership in that community, then that's going to destroy the community. If you're constantly investing in the community and you're like a peon, and you know there's a very vague carrot being dangled in front of you of actually being able to participate in some real way beyond just, like, giving your money and time.
Yeah, I keep making the joke that if I have one more person show up an hour into an event we're doing and shrug cutely and roll their eyes and do a sheer hair flip and go, Pagan Standard Time, and giggle, I'm going to sell them to a brothel in Hong Kong.
Now,
with I Like It Rough tattooed on their foreheads.
Yeah, we had someone one time who drove up with their headlights on high beams in the middle of ritual, and we were just like, what was that about?
Yeah.
Why didn't you just like go and stay in town and get a cup of coffee until you knew we were done?
And we had a guy that would, he'd showed up late a couple of times, but he would call someone and say, hey, my boss held me over 30 minutes. Should I come on or should I just, you know, bow out? And we'd always tell him, come on, just because he was nice enough to and considerate enough to ask whether he should come. I don't mind that. That's different. That's still being considerate.
Mm-hmm. On the flip side of that, you also have where, yes, you want things to start on time, and somebody showing up an hour late and going, oh, Pagan Standard Time, is really just inconsiderate and unnecessary. I was talking with Joyce about the powwow, and she would say that there are some times when, yes, they try to start everything on time, but sometimes with some rituals, it just feels wrong, or something feels right to either do it a little bit earlier or wait a little bit later. So there are a couple exceptions, but it comes to, yes, respecting the community, but also respecting the spirit that goes into it. So sometimes it can be a little bit of back and forth, you know?
I still think that's a communication thing there, though. Because you've got, like, again, if it's not going to work quite like everybody thought it would, and I mean, we've done a lot of pagan, like, public rituals in Freedom Park, that kind of thing, and we've showed up and found out, oh my God, somebody's having a parade party. But if you kind of keep your communication clear and go, okay, guys, this is what we're going to have to do and why, you're still showing someone that you respect the fact that they're there and doing their time by keeping them informed. As much, I mean, everybody's got screw bars and cluster fracks and stuff like that, but you show that by letting people know what's going on and keeping your communication open.
You know, here's an experience that a friend of mine had. They were up for initiation, and they were married to someone who was not at all interested in paganism, thought the whole thing was weird, and they were told that the ritual would start at 9 p.m., and so they figured, you know, if the ritual started a little bit late, if things ran a little bit long, they would probably be home by midnight-ish. That was their expectation, so they told their spouse that they'd do something with them the next day. And they arrived like at 8:30. They were told to go into the other room and wait, and they weren't called until 2 a.m.
Oh, bugger all.
Yeah.
That's equally inconsiderate.
Yeah, so there are groups out
How
there.
How rude.
Yeah, and there are a lot of groups and who feel that people who are seekers, and Kara and I have had this discussion before, that people who are seekers, people who are newbies, who are students, aren't deserving of any kind of respect, and I feel that's very wrong.
That drives me insane.
I don't feel
that attitude.
I don't think that counts as ordeal. I'm sorry, that doesn't count as an ordeal.
Yeah.
Here's a thought.
Now let's say, oh dear.
Is there
sorry.
Anybody in this room that is in not some shape, way, or form human? Okay, cool. Now since we're all human,
oh,
in some shape,
right.
Or form.
Scurvy, aren't you a raccoon?
Oh, yeah. Don't worry, sir. We already exempted you. Okay, it's all good. But normally you get a side by this point. Now we're all gonna make a mistake, right? Let's brainstorm.
Sure.
To what to do after you make a mistake.
Mop bucket.
You cover it up and lie. I'm sorry.
Sure, blame the leader. The leader did it. It's the leader's fault. That's why he's the leader. It's his. That's right. And it was your fault, so I was going to blame you.
I was going to blame you.
Right.
It wasn't a mistake.
No.
It was my true will.
Hey, Star, I did this today, didn't I?
What did you do today?
I did this today, didn't I?
Oh,
so
yeah, you did.
It was a teeny.
I did. Sometimes you got to get a mop bucket is right. You got to go back and clean it up. And sometimes you got to ask your community members to help you clean it up. And usually, like today, they're more than willing to do that.
Depends how big the mess is.
You know, sometimes you that saying... Goes to...
Oops.
Peter just cut out all of a sudden.
I was just going to say that goes to being willing to say, hey, I made a mistake and I need some help fixing it, which is not something that some people can do.
Right.
Yeah.
Be person enough to own up to what you've done.
You know, most of the time if you make a mistake and you immediately recognize it and you do say, oh, crap, I did this. Can you help me?
Yeah.
People don't jump on you like they do when you try to lie and cover shit up. Lying and covering shit up, okay, that's a bad community member. That breaks up community. Making mistakes does not break up community. Owning up to them and asking people, I did this, can you help me? Or I did this, and this is what I'm doing to try to fix it. Or even, I did this, and now I have no freaking clue what the hell I'm going to do. Suggestions, that brings the community together.
You know, on the other, on the flip side of that, also, you know, you can't automatically assume because someone made a mistake or because someone didn't do things the way that you thought that they should have, that their intent was malicious. Because, you know, there's that issue as well where we've had, I've personally had, you know, an instance where, you know, I did everything I was supposed to. I followed all... You know, all the protocols and chain of command and whatever, and something I did irritated someone, and, you know, they immediately came after me, assuming that, you know, what I did was malicious and of ill intent. And, you know, you have to give people the benefit of the doubt, because, you know, generally if you point out to someone politely, you know, hey, you got this wrong, people will generally go, oh, you know, I'm sorry, and they'll do their best to fix it if they can.
Yeah.
Where is the quote? There's a quote, never attribute to malice what can be explained by ignorance or dumb luck. And I can't remember who said it. I love that. I want it on a freaking t-shirt, and I can't remember who said it. Anybody know that one?
No.
You know,
I think whoever it is should be our leader.
Okay.
I would Google that, but my shit internet would probably stop.
I've tried that.
Hey, rock on to me.
My recording rig right now is involving three computers in its entirety. I'm not touching a damn thing.
Yeah, I'm just, you know, cool. I just rub my computer occasionally and try to think good thoughts its way.
Like a tribble.
Being as we don't know who said it, let's attribute it to Scurvy and elect him the leader.
Oh, hell no.
Have we thought this through, Peter?
Don't make Scurv cry.
My leadership skills are normally for single tasks, and normally I wouldn't so much call it as a leader as a head conspirator.
Yeah.
So
that should be on a business card.
One thing we haven't talked about, we've sort of like talked around it a little bit, is if you have someone who is a malicious shit stirrer, who, you know, that's not good for community, how do you deal with that both as a community member and as a leader?
You know, malicious shit stirrers start out as gossips. They start out with one person, and they, hey, do you know this about so-and-so, or do you know this? And it's when we don't draw the line at the very beginning and end up with the malicious stir. You know, I said, I'm not going to listen to that. I'm not interested. And I think sometimes we enable these people because we're so tolerant, and we're so tolerant of new people and new ideas that sometimes we just let that stuff go, and maybe we shouldn't.
Thank you.
Yeah, you know, I think that's a big one. I don't think people realize how absolutely destructive gossiping and backstabbing is to destroying community. It's, wow. It's, you know, and I've seen it at work. I mean, you see it wherever you are. Lack of community is directly in proportion to amount of bullshit gossip going on.
Well, you know, I one time had, I was trying to get some information on a particular tradition, and instead of sending me information on the tradition, someone sent me, like, all of this really malicious gossip about someone in the pagan community.
Do you still have it?
Yeah, but I'm not going to repeat it. I'm not going to repeat it.
I'm sorry.
And my response to the person was, you know, I'm not interested and anyone giving me unverified, you know, malicious gossip about people. That's not what I'm interested in, and I appreciate it if you would delete this off of my Facebook. And they did. And, you know, you just, yeah. You know, I agree with you and Peter that, you know, you've just got to say no. Uh-uh, not going to happen.
And I think you're dead on there, too. I've seen several groups that I was either involved in the periphery of or had something to do with blow sky high or fizzle out to nothing because there was a shit stirrer and a malicious gossip, and no one would put their foot down and say, call them on their bullshit. I think the thing that pagans have of wanting to be inclusive, and I think these people learn to work the idea of tolerance as a weapon to keep people from shutting them up or telling them go play in your own sandbox, because people want to be inclusive and they want to be tolerant, but it's a case of being so open-minded that your brains fall out.
It's also confrontation, though. If it's a clear-cut yes or no situation, it's easier to be able to suck it up and go to that person and go, look, you're screwing things up, shoo, go away. But if it's somebody that you care about and somebody that you have, even if it's just a friendship, I mean, friendship's still a big deal, but you understand. Even if it's a friendship and that person has done something that you don't approve of, that confrontation, you understand, has the possibility of breaking that friendship. And that is a big thing for a lot of people.
I got to toss a tough love thing in there, and I piss people off on a regular basis. It's a shame I can't burn calories by it. But if someone does something that makes you lose, I don't mean just get aggravated with them. I mean something that makes you lose respect for them and doubt their integrity. And you let it slide. I mean, you don't have to go say, hey, stupid, you screwed up. What an idiot are you? Not the first time anyway. And if you're really their friend and you really feel like, okay, you are diminishing yourself by this, and you don't broach it with them, that falls into the realm of enabling to me. If they're an honest person who's not doing this out of malice, a malicious agenda, or just because they're just a tawdry little bugger, then even if it makes them angry, they're going to think about it, and they might see, okay, maybe I need to look at this differently, or maybe I may make some adjustments. If they are the type of person that's doing this out of a spirit of malice or because they're just sorry, and I mean pathetic sad sorry, not apologetic sorry, one, you don't need that person as a friend, and number two, you're telling them that is not going to lose you and is not going to lose your friendship because they were never your friends to begin with.
We call that the booger rule. If you have something in your teeth, if you have a booger hanging out, if you did something that made you look like a jackass, or friends, don't talk about such things, right? So we just call that the booger rule.
There you go.
I like that.
I am so stealing that.
Yep. Taken.
You know, we...
Another thing I would offer. Okay, I'll go. Criticism. Let's say, hypothetically, I think snooze is being a poop head.
Yay!
So here's what I'm going to do with snooze. Snooze and I, we're going to go walk over here. I'm going to see if I can catch some one-on-one time with snooze. And I'm going to say, hey, this is what I'm seeing.
Tara,
there you go.
Hypothetical, by the way.
No. That's exactly it. Because when you say to somebody, this is how it looks from where I'm at, then you're not saying you're being an evil, rotten, maggot-riddled little bastard. You're saying from over here, that's what's showing. And that gives them the opportunity to either say, oh, but this is what's going on this side where you can't see, and or explain what's going on, or that gives them the opportunity to go, well, crap, that's not what I meant at all, and everybody gets a chance to clean stuff up.
Right.
You know, Scurvy, one thing about that, though, is that's if you have a personal relationship with someone or a friendship with someone, you know, I'm not going to go into the details, but in the past month or so, we've had, you know, a pagan elder who has made a public comment that a lot of people thought was really, really out of line. And, you know, in that case, you know, it becomes, you know, a thing where the community has to make a decision on how to respond to that. And some people decided to be silent, and some people decided to be vociferously, you know, against this person because they made this horrible comment. And, you know, and then some people were like, well, you know, you have to balance, you know, what the person said against their contributions to the community. And it becomes a very public thing. You know, you can't always, like, walk up to someone and say, hey, can I talk to you for a second? Because, you know, I've kind of got a concern.
Something around here, in the deep south that I've seen happen, is that it's much better, or it seems like it's the appropriate thing to do, to be polite and to be nice and to seem like you really love everybody around you. And so if someone does things that you don't like, you don't get confrontational, you don't address the issue, you act like this person is your best friend anyway, but then you go and talk smack to everyone else behind their backs.
Well, no, well, isn't it in the South that when you do something jackassery or something, then they say, well, isn't that
bless your heart. Or,
yeah, bless your heart.
Bless your heart.
Yeah. Heart's yeah.
Right.
And that just means, oh, you were such a jackass. I can't believe that just happened.
He's right, though. One of the things that I find really frustrating is I would rather someone say, you know, look at this god-awful mess you made. Can I, you know, I can't believe you did this. And again, like Scurv, I would whole lot rather somebody come up to me and say, this is what it looks like you're doing, and be able to say, that's not what I mean, or say, okay, maybe I am taking the wrong end of the stick on this. Tell me what you know. But people won't do that. And I think there's a combination of we must be tolerant and we must be inclusive. And I was talking to several people I've talked to people at a couple of festivals around the country, mostly on the East Coast or Midwest. And it's not just in the South, but we do seem to have a large dose of it, that one must never, ever, ever say anything unpleasant. And then you have a dose of a pagan want to blame it on New Agers, but don't want to think that's fair, so I'm not going to do that completely. Excuse me. Thing that we must never say anything negative. We must never have negativity. And all conflict is automatically seen as negativity, no matter what kind of conflict it is. So you've got this great big huge pile of elephant dung in the middle of the room that everybody is walking around and pretending isn't there, and nobody tells you it's there for you to go get a shovel. But they're angry with you because you don't know it's there.
Yeah, that's very insidious, too. That's insidious. The whole, on the surface, they're not saying anything wrong, but really they're trashing people. I've got people in my family who have that down to, you know, a sweet Southern art form. And that's kind of insidious, too. And it's difficult to deal with. I just don't talk to those relatives. That's how I deal with it.
As a good community member, if you really want to be one, make sure you're approachable in some way.
Well, it's this other thing. There isn't about being approachable. It's about not wanting to approach.
Mm-hmm.
A person can be as approachable as the guy who drives the ice cream van, but if the person who is aware of the mess in the middle of the room does not want to approach you to say, hey, there's a mess in the middle of the room, he's not going to approach you, but he will tell everyone else that that person made a mess in the middle of the room, oh, look how bad he is.
I have a better way to illustrate that than what I just said.
But back to an earlier point for something we're not quite talking about at the moment, but I understand recently there's been a topic that wasn't supposed to be broached but came up slightly where there was somebody who was making a big stink, and what was said, I can't remember who said it was. Actually, it wasn't said anyway.
Tell us what was said, and maybe we can figure it out.
It's craptastic.
Craptastic.
Are you talking about what I was referring to? Up in chat.
Yeah.
Big mop bucket.
Oh, then again, at that point in time, that's just a troll too. Maybe.
Hey, I found it. Cool.
Well, thanks for saying the name, Scurvy. Now you have to edit that out. No, that's what I was talking about. I don't know which drama you're referring to.
Oh, that was some pretty big drama.
Yeah, it was.
But I found what I was looking for, and I started to say a second ago, I can illustrate what I was talking about better than I just did, and this does actually tie into that. People have this idea that peacefulness in a community or unity in a community has to do with everything being shiny, everything being neat, everything being smooth. And there's this fantastic quote from Dorothy Thompson. It's one of my favorites of hers, and she has plenty. Peace is not the absence of conflict, but the presence of creative alternatives for responding to conflict. And I think that's one of the biggest things we have that is a difficulty in community, is not having creative alternatives for responding to conflict. Instead, there's an idea that conflict at all must be avoided no matter what it is. And to me, that's like sitting there and letting a splinter turn into a ball until it bursts on its own, instead of taking some tweezers to it and lancing it before it gets to be that big of a problem.
Now, we've actually had to deal with a little bit of drama as a podcast, and one thing that I've always been strong on is nobody can fix their problems if you don't tell them that something is a problem. If you're not coming up to somebody and saying, look, your actions are out of line, they may have absolutely no self-awareness of that particular issue. If you don't bring it up because you're trying to be polite or you're trying to just hope it goes away, you're not giving them an opportunity to notice that flaw and fix it. And sometimes, taking from another perspective, if somebody comes to you and says, look, you know, you were really out of line here, and you're all offended, usually the more offended you are, the more truth that person has to say, and maybe you should shut up and take a minute to listen to what they have to say.
You know, to continue with the kind of simile that she was using a minute ago about, you know, somebody getting a splinter, it's also not wise to, you know, go up while the child is still in tears and try to take the splinter out. Sometimes there is something to sitting back for a little while until emotions calm down. If somebody behaves badly, for instance, and whether they do it through, you know, jealousy or whatever the emotion is, and they're not being authentic, sometimes you need to give them a little bit of space before you come up and confront that, because you want to do it in a way that they're going to be open to it.
Well, instead of, like, poking and gaping open wound, you mean?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, I mean, if somebody acts tender. Badly and you walk right up to them and say, you shouldn't have done that, and you were really impolite to that person, and that was really rude because of this issue that you have, that's not productive either. That's escalatory. And yeah. I think the great example is, you know, something was brought up just a minute ago about, you know, a well-known pagan leader that said something that was, to say it nicely, heavily inconsiderate in the way it was phrased. And that doesn't even go to the content of what was said, just in the way it was phrased. And sitting back for a few days, the people who got really upset about that after a few days were suddenly writing nice things about that person and all they'd done for the community. So, I mean, sometimes there is something to a pause, but that doesn't mean we go to the Southern tradition of just ignoring it totally.
Exactly. That's that happy medium thing there. You know, it's,
yeah.
Again, you don't have to go up and say, give me your finger, stupid, and start jabbing at it with a massive knitting needle. It's how you handle it. You know, okay, listen, chick, let me get the splinter out now, and it'll stop hurting them way faster than if it just stays in there and I let, and you know, you let it ride.
Right.
So being a good community member is someone who's willing to you know, show a little consideration for other people's feelings and be able to meet people halfway. And, you know, whether that's talking about compromise or not, you know, that's not even to that point. It's just being willing to meet people halfway. When you're talking about if you have a problem with something or you see something you don't like or you see a behavior or that type of thing, and going up and talking to that person and the other person being willing to at least listen to it, doesn't mean you both have to agree on that. It means meeting each other halfway and listening to it and understanding this is how I saw it, and the other person realizing, okay, someone took it this way. I think that shows being a good community member, but it also means that both people have to show some bravery and some moral courage. You know, even if someone has a strong personality, and I'll tell you, sometimes, yes, I'll act like a jackass. I'll say something thoughtless, or I didn't think it through, or it just hit the wrong way, or whatever. And, you know, when people come up to me and if they say, God, Kara, that was really fucked up. Why did you say that? You know, and I think about it, I feel bad, you know, and I'm like, I'm sorry, and I do what I can to correct that. When people don't tell me that, I don't know. But on the flip side of that, I got to tell you, I don't have a lot of patience for people who are then unwilling to say something. Instead, they just sit there thinking whatever, and then you know, write me off as like, oh, she's a bad person. No, I'm not a bad person. Just give me a chance. You know, and I'll do the same for you. And I, you know, when people come up to me and talk to me, you know, I'm not an asshole back to them about that stuff. I think a lot of people are that way. Even if you see them acting angrily or something like that, when you talk to them later, they're embarrassed or they feel bad or, you know, they might make amends. But you've got some courage. Give them the chance. And likewise, if someone comes to you, you've got to have the courage to address them.
You know, I've had it.
See in the world.
Yeah. You know, I've had it happen a couple of times where, you know, I've written something and I've written it poorly and people call me on my BS. And generally, like, mm-hmm. you know, 99% of the time, you know, I'm like, you know, you've got a good point and I think about it. And sometimes I write something, you know, reflecting the fact that I've taken this person's criticism into consideration. And sometimes you have to do that. Sometimes you have to be able to sit there and accept what's coming your way. Even if it comes, you know, in a manner that you may not entirely appreciate.
There's a flip side to that too, that I don't know. I use it. Some people agree with me. Some people don't. Have I whipped out broccoli and peaches thing yet?
No.
Did I do that yet? Okay.
No.
There's the times when you've got someone that you simply are not going to reach an understanding with, or you're just not, even with compromise, you're simply not going to reach a ground that both of you can agree on. You can agree not only to disagree, but you can also agree to disengage, and give each other a little bit extra boundary space. I'm not everybody's kind of people. Now, I'm nowhere near everybody's kind of people. And the metaphor that I like to use is broccoli and peaches. Broccoli's great. Peaches are great. But you wouldn't put them in a casserole together. Okay, if you would put them in a casserole together, I'm never eating at your house, okay?
I'll make sure not to let in cook when you come by.
Arigato gozaimashita. But they're both very, very good things, but they don't mix. And I don't necessarily think that it's a failure to sometimes look at each other and say, we are simply not going to mix, but we don't have to take it out on everybody else around us. We had someone in our community that effectively was not speaking to us and hated and loathed our very existence on this planet, and I wasn't particularly crazy about them either. For a year, we went to meetups, we went to gatherings, we went to Pagan Pride Day. Nobody knew that we had had this really, really huge, massive, nasty blow-up because we didn't engage, we stayed out of each other's hair, and we just gave each other boundaries and space. And I feel like reaching a resolution to conflict and compromise is your best goal. But if you can't get that, I think it's possible to still have some measure of success and still not take it out on the rest of the community. And I kind of feel like if more people would maybe give that a shot, maybe it wouldn't be so hard and it wouldn't be so explosive if they actually just went ahead and said, okay, sometimes it's not going to work, and sometimes it's not going to work perfect. It's not going to be that highest goal.
I think I'm noticing something, and this may be just me and it might not be exactly clear, is that it seems that a lot of the miscommunication, even with all of us trying to explain our point of view and then it gets modified, and then it seems to be going from one extreme to the other. Someone will say about, you know, how you present it, and then somebody else will say, yes, but you have to do it this way, and then it seems that we're all talking about the extremes because that's what people do, and the thought process is like 50 miles an hour, so trying to formulate this into a coherent thought, so please forgive me. There's so much where people are afraid that they're not being heard, not understood, not fitting in. They want the community, but only the way they want it. And that's, it almost seems like a problem with people not feeling comfortable with who they are, and that's coming out in how they react. Because if you're not comfortable with who you are, then everything offends you because you're so scared of losing yourself in everybody else going and believing somebody else. Like if somebody is saying this word means pagan, or this word does not mean pagan, or we should call ourselves this way, and you get offended and start foaming at the mouth on how that's true, oh, that's not true, and nobody should ever listen, and rawr, and posting everywhere, and to the meaning of paganism, and the meaning of, I think it stems, yes, from communication, and problems with communicating your ideas, but I think on a deeper level, it stems from not being able to look at yourself and saying that something makes you uncomfortable, figuring out what it is and how to fix it on a personal level before you reach out and fix it for somebody else.
There you go.
Some people come into pagan communities who might be finding their way through themselves after leaving a Christian community or somebody else, where they didn't find what they wanted, and they're in this personal battle of neuroses. And so they come to pagan groups, pagan communities, pagan whatevers, hoping that if new group will fix them, or mend them, or tell them it's all okay, and then if they don't find the fix they want, then they have animosity towards this new group for not being the instance psychological band-aid that they hoped it was going to be.
I fell in love with a cute boy. Why isn't my life all better now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Magic bullet.
You can usually see these people coming because they usually start out with, oh, this is the best thing in the world, and you're the greatest leader in the world, and you're such this great person, or this is such this great group, and they just, you know that they're just going to go the polar opposite on you. I've seen it time and time again.
That's a borderline personality disorder.
Yes, it is.
Yep.
A person I knew who, after meeting me for about 2 weeks, this is a man who was in the terminal phase of HIV, and for like 2 weeks, and he said he wanted to bequeath all his worldly goods to me, and to me to perform his requiem and do all these things. He had all these great, like, glumming onto me, like anything, and I barely even knew the guy. That made me uncomfortable.
How much did he have?
Well, not...
Well, I'm going with my will, but that's only because I have a really, really, really evil person in it that's not getting a whole heck of a lot. And, you know, I figure if I'm leaving this world, I'd really owe my friends one last good sucker punch.
I would expect nothing less from you.
You know,
Egyptians take everything with them.
Oh, no, I fully believe in sharing the love. Besides, it would warm my heart and soul to know that after I'm worm food, that I still got everyone back one last time from beyond the grave.
So, and to you, last will and testament, goes this hand grenade. Here, hold it by the pin.
I want to make a comment about the neurotic little pagans. You know, that happens, and it's unfortunate because it's usually people who haven't had enough time or a chance to get their own head in order. Because conversion is a huge process. It's a huge process for anyone to go through. But, you know, I think that these people, even though that they can be a little whacked out and crazy, you know, that's not to say that, you know, a year or two down the road, you shouldn't give them a second chance. I can speak from experience. After my divorce, I had a boyfriend that I went completely psycho on. I will admit it. I was the psycho girlfriend. I went completely psycho on him. I wouldn't have blamed him for getting a restraining order against me because my head was, like, in a really bad blaze.
That's kind of turning me on, Star. I'm kind of picturing you in a whole new light.
That's where the hair came from.
But, you know, I'm not that person anymore. I don't do that. And
I'm sorry, Star. Were you talking? I have a fantasy going.
For all you listeners out there in Radio Land, we shared a hotel room at Pantheacon.
And a bed. Thank you very much. Star thought it was a mistake. Silly her.
I don't have to deposit back because if you did, then you didn't do nearly as much as you're sounding like.
But you know, I mean, I've changed over the years. I'm not the same person I was 6 years ago. So, you know, I would hate for my one neurotic incident to color the rest of my life going forward.
Well, and that's true. you know, I mean, yes, we have, you know, people who are coming in new and they're going through a huge adjustment period. And, you know, you have to make allowances for that because we were all, unless, of course, we're one of the pagans who were raised in the religion, we all went through that to a greater or lesser degree. And people have things going on in their lives. But I think it's a valid statement to make that it's hard to be a good community member if you're mentally kind of fucked up. You know, if you're in a bad place at the moment, you know, because if your headspace isn't good, it's really hard to have decent interactions with other people and to be able to judge reality. I know if I'm feeling really sad, things affect me more than if I'm feeling really happy. And that's just on, you know, your slight emotional swings that you regularly go through. Well, if you're having something major going on in your life or you have a mental illness that is not under treatment, that's quite a bit exasperated. So it's very challenging for you to be a good community member. And on the flip side, I think because paganism has a strong core to it that has this almost self-improvement type of thing going on to it, we attract people who are in a bad place mentally, yeah, emotionally, spiritually.
You guys keep quoting my blog, and I know for a fact that you've never read it. I'm laughing my butt off over here. Now that's like three different blog entries I've got. I love you people. This is a discussion that we had. We've had two people try to combine themselves with the group that we were doing there for about 5 years that we're taking a break from, who were certifiably mentally ill. They needed professional treatment. And that's me saying that. And I can't stand pop psych. But they wound up causing a great deal of harm in the community because when if you are having a mental difficulty, and sometimes that's just the way it works out. It's like, you know, it's just one of those things. You work on it, you get the mop, you get the bucket. But when you're in that headspace, you're not really going to agree that you're in that headspace because that's one of the parts of being in that headspace. And the other flip side of being a good community member is knowing where your limits are. And we had way too many people, and I've talked to other people that they've run into the same thing, who instead of saying, okay, this person needs to talk to a professional, have said, oh, but you can't do that. We have to heal them. It's our job as magicians and magic workers and healers and so on, so on, fill in the blank, whatever you want, to heal this person.
Oh, Kelly Mae!
People think that way. Yeah. And not only is it unfair to a person who really, it's back to that, you know, addressing something that for potential conflict thing versus ignoring it and just being nice. It's not fair to the person who is ill. It's not fair to the community either. I've used this analogy so much lately, I feel like an idiot, but even if it's a rabid dog, not a rabid dog's fault that it's got rabies, you still can't let it run loose biting people. That's irresponsible. And we've got too many people saying, oh, but it's mean to lock the poor doggy up, pet, pet, pet. Here, have a biscuit. And yeah, exactly. It's like, guys, come on. It's,
you know,
let me check one other thing in here and I will shut up, I promise, but this is actually kind of important. I've said this to someone in our community that was largely responsible for influencing that opinion with people and saying that it is important to know where your limits are of what your capabilities are. The answer that I got back was that I was afraid of my own power.
Oh, wow.
And that is a big problem. That attitude is a serious problem.
You know, one thing I think is an issue, and there are pagan leaders and authors who characterize pagan groups, who characterize groves and covens and circles and you know, the different ways we characterize our groups, who characterize them as being group therapy. As if yeah. this is where you go. You don't need a mental health professional. All you need is, you know, a good grove or circle or coven or kindred. And you all sit together. Yeah, yeah. And that is the whole purpose and goal of that. And it's not. The goal is spiritual development. It's not working through people's mental illness issues. That's something that's really sort of a professional thing. It's not that spirituality won't help you with that, but that's not the purpose of what we're doing, you know?
It's a coven. It isn't a 12-step program.
Right, exactly. And it's not that those two things are completely opposite each other, that they don't work well together, but that's not the purpose of what we're doing. And I've read books where people they describe it as if it's group therapy, and the way they talk about it is if it's group therapy, and you know, this is how you're going to work through, you know, all of your abandonment issues, and you're going to do it as a group, and you know, it's going to be very loving, and that's not, I don't think it's realistic, and I don't think it's responsible to give that impression that this is a replacement for seeking help from a mental health professional.
I love y'all, but if I had to depend on all of you for my mental health, I think there would be a
problem. Kirby's going to leave everything to you in his will.
Oh, no, not everything to Amber. No, trust me.
Except a penny. That goes to my sister.
You better to get Miles to put you in the will. Sounds like he got a bunch of stuff lately.
But I also
you're like
say,
a sister to me. How could I deprive you of that?
That's horrifying, Scurvy.
Hey, you know, guys, having worked in mental health a little bit and actually dealt with borderline personality disorders, the one thing I'd like to say is I've seen situations where people who were mentally ill were totally shut out by their spiritual community, and I think it's important to create healthy boundaries. I mean, if you have a coven that has public rituals, still inviting them to things like that, not shutting them out of it, but I think it's about, does the group itself have really healthy boundaries rather than about the mentally ill person? Because I'm not sure 100% shutouts are really positive solution. I mean, they need to get help, they need to get counseling, and there's certain levels of participation that they can't have until that happens.
Yeah, no, right,
we lost participants, though, because one of our guys was stalking three of our female members, and because he was not excluded from some of our events, other people quit coming because they weren't going to be around someone who made them that uncomfortable or actually made them afraid. The 27-year-old that was going after the 14-year-old is the one that still boggles my mind. But it's, I think, again, it's one of those, you got to look at everything individually. I agree with you 100% until it lapses over into from maybe a little out of balance to completely fracking whacked out of recognition.
I think it's a difference of between, like you said, instead of using recognition, maybe just dangerous?
Well, I was going to, I mean, I've always liked FUBAR, but I don't know if everybody else uses that term.
FUBAR is a good term.
Yeah. One How many military people we got here? A clusterfuck works good, too.
One of my main problems, or my main complaints when it comes to spirituality and mental health is that it seems like spirituality is the answer for all of it. They're not schizophrenic, they're blessed. They're not bipolar, they're passionate. And I've never been able to wrap my head around how you cannot understand, and that, you know, they'll take the fact that there are spiritual and metaphysical answers that have come up in science, and science has recognized it, and they're like, oh, that gives me leeway to take this and run with it.
Like when they passed a ruling that ADHD is a legitimate condition. It's not just that, oh, he's just not paying attention. Now he has this condition that is quantifiable, but it also means that he can use this as a crutch. He can blame everything on his ADHD. It is bad for some people, but...
Yeah, because they really screw stuff up for people that actually do have something that can be tied to a chemical imbalance or some type of, God, I hate the word trauma, but some type of traumatic event that has seriously affected the way that they interact or deal with the world or their coping skills, and it makes their problem cheap. And if nothing else, I agree with you, I despise them for that because it makes it so much harder for someone who has a real problem. Oh, look, pizza.
People, I now have trouble doing stuff. I know how to organize things in my life. So it's most productive for me and the people around me, and moderately less traumatic for the people around me. Love the scary silence there. But because of poo-poo heads like that, the moment I say ADD, no. All sorts of flags go up. You got people saying blah, 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 blah. People using that as a blah, blah, blah. Thing. Okay? I just want everything in harm's reach. That's it.
What I'm sorry, Kirby. What were you saying? I wasn't paying attention.
Start.
So I got this on a time study once. If I have to take two steps to go to my toolbox, I got 50-50 odds of getting lost.
You know, I've done the reading on ADHD, and I look at it and I go, you know what, I think I'm ADHD too, but a lot of times on that particular issue, some of the things that are hallmarks of ADHD can also be skills that you can put to your own advantage. So, you know.
Lack of ability to speak. ADHD is a context disorder mostly. That's actually a condition that you can have and be the better for it.
Mm-hmm.
ADHD, well, you want that person as a paramedic. You do that whole awesome adventure.
Oh my God, he's focused.
ADHD, do not get it treated. It will kill
you. You know,
responsible management, which is what you're talking about. The difference is, I got a buddy that has, she's got some focus issues on. I don't think, it's not ADHD. She actually had a brain injury when she was a kid. But she spends her day managing it. She has a handle on it. She defines it. She knows where its boundaries are, and she keeps it on a leash to the best of her ability. The flip side are people that say, oh, I have fill in the blank, and require everyone else around them, instead of adjusting and managing themselves to the rest of the world, they require the rest of the world to adjust and manage itself for just them, and that's not functional.
You know,
I paid attention when I was in school to the subcategories that the teachers would place the ADHD students in. I think, and this is just going off that, so we know this is obvious. We know years of clinical experience and hands-on experience, blah, 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 and all that fun stuff isn't valid at all, but I think you can group ADHD into, at least five different other conditions, but it's a blanket term.
You know, I have friends, and some of them are pagan, who have issues with anxiety disorders, issues with agoraphobia, with OCD, and they're very honest about where they're at and how they're feeling and what their limitations are, and they don't use it as a crutch. So they're able to actually interact really well with the people in their lives and their surroundings and their spiritual groups, because, you know, we know that, you know, if someone says, you know, I can't go there today, I'm not in a good space today, then nobody argues, you know, but they make the effort to join in to group projects and that sort of thing, and they make their limitations known pretty well, and so they actually function really, really well. It doesn't have to be, it doesn't have to be a crutch, you know. It can just be something where you're very honest with the people around you, and, you know, and people will respect that, you know. I have a friend, if they tell me that, you know, they can't go somewhere, or if they tell me that they need to go somewhere, but they need me to go with them, then I'm like, yeah, mm-hmm. totally. You know, I have a friend who has some issues with agoraphobia, and sometimes it's easier for them if they go places with people than by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So if they need to, like, go to the grocery store, then yeah, totally, I will go to the grocery store with you. That's no issue. And, you know, it's being honest about your limitations that helps you integrate well into to any sort of group, whether it's a group of friends or a spiritual community or whatever.
See, to me, taking that kind of responsibility is success. The fact that you got an obstacle, you got to work around, big whoop. Everybody's got those. But if you're actually saying, okay, I'm going to try to get a handle on this, and this is my game plan, then to me, having an issue or an obstacle is nothing. The fact that you are dealing with it is the success. And screw the rest of it. Everybody's got something.
What really bugs me, I confess, is those people in a pagan community or group or coven or something who they know how to fix every single one of everybody's problems, and everyone should do it their way. You've got this condition. I can help you fix that. You're depressed over this here. If you hold this rock and rub this way, you'll be better. But everyone has to do it the way that I say you have to do it.
See, Miles, that's people being all up in your grill without even knowing what the flavor of the Kool-Aid is. It's not working.
Nice analogy.
So, yeah, it is. It's people interjecting themselves as an expert when they're not, and then telling you what to do. You should do this, and whether that's to correct a problem or... You know, and there's a difference between someone saying, okay, you were kind of a jerk when you do this, and someone walking up to you and saying, oh my God, is that a dead fucking animal on your plate? You should not eat that because of blah, 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 while you're eating it.
Yeah.
It's like, yes, you know what? I've been through a slaughterhouse. I know exactly how this fucker was killed, and it's goddamn tasty. So get out of my area.
You know,
I mean, I'm not going to walk up to them and go, here, you should eat this, and, like, put it up to their face. You know, and there's different examples of that. But, yeah, just people interjecting and then, like, forcing their shit on you is just, okay, pet peeve.
There's somebody... I'm sorry.
Made by child slave labor, Malaysia?
Why, yes, their little fingers can sew so well.
Somebody is a fantastic... I'm sorry, go ahead. I was going to tell you, somebody that's a fantastic success story on that. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, you know, if someone is dealing with some sort of mental illness or behavioral order, and they're doing their best and they're being honest about it, you know, telling them to get over it or just hold this rock and that'll make everything better is like the absolutely worst thing you can do. That is just,
Star, can I balance your chakras? Because that will make everything immediately all better.
You may not. These are my chakras. And I want everyone's hands off of them. Yeah. I have my own theories about chakras that I'm not going to go into because that's a big tangent.
I have people that come in the booth that's what they want. They want the magic rock that will fix everything. And I'll pick up one that's like really big and really heavy. And not necessarily particularly the shiniest or the prettiest one, and tell them to go sit in the corner with it for a few minutes and listen to it. And then when they calm down a little bit because they realize that it's not doing anything, then they actually come up and they start chit-chatting with other people and start talking about what's bugging them, and they actually get somewhere.
Do you ever have people say, oh my God, this rock was freaking awesome. It helped me 100%.
Well, you know, there is such a thing as a placebo effect, too. And as long as it works, I'm okay with that, as long as the person realizes that, yes, it's a placebo effect. But if you can do your willing suspension and disbelief and still make it work, who cares?
And there's somebody else I know who saw a friend's rock and so much fell in love with that rock.
Oh, God,
rock.
Don't bring him up. I'm repressing that whole incident.
Skate over the issue.
God.
Fell in love with this one rock, sent emails just about demanding that this rock, that they were, like, having imaginary sex with, should be handed over to them. It was beyond obsessive.
Imaginary sex with a rock?
Welcome.
Honey, you don't even want to know. This guy doesn't just need therapy. This guy actually needs chemicals in a padded room somewhere. Yeah, I found that we found out later on that he's also a meth head, and has been for quite some time. But he's a prized and valued elder in one of the local groups, and you know, so he's got a following, and he's happy, and they're happy, and I'm okay if they hate my guts, but they're still not getting my rock.
Okay. I have a question. Was there like a hole in this rock? I'm sorry. I'm kind of obsessing about having sex with rock. What the hell?
Tag me. Listen. Tag me off list sometime, because it'd make a good thesis paper for somebody. I swear to God, it would. If I could stomach sociology long enough to major in it. I would do it just so I could do a paper on this freak. But yeah, it boggles the mind. But there,
do you realize again,
it's back to the same point though. We have people in our community that no matter, and the stuff that he started sending me, I'm not even going to repeat on here. And that's me saying that. And I've been in construction most of my life, and I've got a mouth that would curl a sailor's hair, and I'm not going to repeat it on here. And we have people in the community that have embraced this guy and now loathe us or me because of my horrible intolerance and my closed-mindedness for what is obviously this man's gift. And this is the reason why sometimes you just got to say, brother, I got to call bullshit on that. And not apologize for it.
You know, I've been told a couple of times, I have enough medical problems that the doctors have looked at me on several occasions and go, how in the world are you still functioning as well as you do? It's great. But when people come in and they're like, oh, well, that's because you've taken antibiotics at some time in your life. And if you take this crystal, and so it's not just the mental problems, it's the physical ones as well that we have to look at. Now, there are enough of people who, oh, I have fibromyalgia, so I can't get out of my house. Oh, bullshit. Get up, get out, too. Quit leaning on your crutch. The physical ones are just as much, but at the same time, anybody that claims that they can fix all of your problems physically if you do what they say, it's the same thing. Sometimes that, yes, energy is out of whack. I'm going to a wonderful, wonderful acupuncturist that is helping, but at the same time, it is still a form of medicine that takes years of study to understand. It's not what she feels with her hands and pokes at it. You know, sometimes there are real dangers to letting people take control of you, whether it's mentally, physically, or anything. And it seems like a lot of people will have this idea that, well, I'm not happy. These people look happy. That means they have something I'm missing. And if I hang out with them, if I listen to them, if I follow them, they will make me happy too.
You know, Amber, I take a lot of offense to that because I once cured tuberculosis by poking someone on Facebook.
Yeah, but where did you poke them?
Jump, boom.
I once knew a guy who claimed that he could teach people how to be psychokinetic based on the kind of tea they drink.
Wow.
Wish I was making that up.
Did the tea have mushrooms in it?
Just
checking.
Never actually saw the tea. Is this same guy who, when I asked him what his zodiac sign is, he said, all of them.
That's cute.
Yeah, good.
You know, here's one other thing that can and you guys have kind of touched upon it, of, you know, a behavior that you see within community members that can kind of be destructive, and that's the charismatic leader, you know, and that's someone who's coming into a group. People generally like them at first because they make themselves very likable, but their intents are really to gain power, and whether that's to get a little harem going on or just have sycophants at their feet or whatever that is, that's what they do, and they are able to suck us into this, and when other people recognize it, they push back very vehemently, and these people are more than willing to break up an entire community just to parcel off their little groups and keep them loyal to them.
I know somebody else who fits that to a T. He breezed into the community on this great whirlwind and said, I'm here now. I can fix all of your problems. Do what I say, and everything is going to be fine, he said. And the elders all winced, and the younger kids ran for cover. And after about 2 weeks, 3 weeks, when people weren't doing what he told them to do, he said, I've told you what to do. You have to do what I say, and everything is going to be good. Obey me, or I will punish you.
You know, Miles,
you can't actually see the gesture that I'm making right now, but just because I don't actually have the correct anatomy doesn't mean I can't use it.
Since Dave isn't here.
Oh, rats, I just blew another ad sponsor. Sorry. No, I didn't just blow another ad sponsor. Oh, never mind. I'll sit down now.
You won't plug your own books. I see how
it is. So,
how perfect you are.
Since Dave isn't here, I'm going to put in our slavery reference for this episode.
Yes.
So, Miles, when people come into town and tell you that they are going to fix everything and they are from out of town, we call that a carpetbagger.
I like it.
We've had people like that in the Atlanta community who have, you know, admittedly, you know, the founder of my tradition was one, but she stuck around and actually did some good. But we've had people come in and they're like, you know, we're here and now, and, you know, we're going to fix the Atlanta pagan community. And all the rest of us were like, oh, really? Sure, this is going to be fun.
Give me some corporate America. We call that consultants.
And you pay. I fix all problems at one time. I simply make myself a worse problem, then all the other problems look better.
See, I like this man's problem-solving skills.
Just remember, it's all my fault. Say it with me.
No.
It's all my fault.
I said I was going to blame you.
That's why you're getting the hate mail.
Well, actually,
you can be one of the people that goes on Pagans who get stuff done.
There you go.
A while ago, you made the observation that the best way to be named leader of something is to not be in the room when the vote is taken. Okay, well,
happened to me.
In that same light, I think that we should blame all the problems on Barrett, because he hasn't spoken yet.
Okay.
Yes.
I was going to vote for Dave.
All right, we are in consensus.
Well, you know, one thing we haven't touched on yet, and it's something that, you know, in the not-so-distant history was, you know, a big problem in pagan communities, is witch wars. You know, I've recently, because an elder died recently that I've been in contact with folks trying to get some information on him, and people keep bringing up stuff from, like, old witch wars that I'm like, yeah, not touching that with a 10-foot pole. But, you know, we really haven't had, you know, witch wars really badly, I would say, in the past 5 years that, you know, everything, hopefully, fingers crossed, seems to have calmed down, you know, so...
On
so,
a global scale, maybe not, but I'm sure little communities have them all the time.
I think that's some, we've got some people that's all they ever do. It's, witch war, though, has gotten to be such a cliche. It's, I don't even know that it's accurate anymore a lot of the time, because it's gotten to the point now where people use it as a bogeyman thought stopper to shut people up. It's like, again, if you disagree with someone, oh, you're starting a witch war, or if you say, hey, listen, that guy really shouldn't come pee in the ritual fire, that's just not done, oh, you're starting a witch war, and it's turned into a bloody cliche. Cricket.
I'm gonna watch crickets for about like 2 minutes to say what we got.
So he has to record again whenever we're doing something that's worthwhile saying.
All right, well, we're recording again. I still got the backup camera over there, so we're still styling.
Oh, okay. So to kind of recap what we've been saying, you know, what tears the community apart is if you are a lying, power-mad, gossiping, backstabbing asshole who can't engage with other people and has to have things absolutely their own way. And if you aren't those things, well, then there's a better chance that you are a good community member and you're not going to completely hose things up. Is that kind of where everyone's going?
Yeah, but then who are we going to circle with?
Damn.
You just eliminated everybody.
Solitary eclectics.
Peter, you have a point.
Cricket.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, to me, it goes down to basic values, to basic manners, to basic respect. If you have respect for people, if you have manners, you know, if, you know, you're working in good faith, then any issue can be resolved. That's how I feel about it. And, you know, you just have to learn to read people and to recognize the people who do have good manners and who do have respect for what you're trying to do in the community you're trying to create, and who are willing to listen.
You know, I agree. What I would add, good boundaries to that. Communities and individuals have to have good boundaries.
Yeah.
There you go. Good neighbors make good fences, sort of thing. Yeah. I've been pulling way too much metaphor tonight. I need to go take aspirin.
I need beer.
I've got mead.
I would take that.
Doesn't help you all the way up there, but...
No.
Where does Kara live?
Minnesota.
Do you really? My goodness. Okay. Just curious.
I have a desire to ask you to say, don't you know, but I'm afraid you would hit me.
Well...
Don't you know?
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
I heard it in the Minnesota. I heard it there.
Yeah, everyone hears it when you say Minnesota. Here's the thing. He's trying to
do Terry Foy.
You know, everyone jokes about how Palin talks and they're like, oh my God, you know, she says you betcha and all that kind of stuff. So they're making all these jokes about how people talk. And us here in Minnesota, we're sitting there going, fuck you all. That's how we talk. Like, we're not from Alaska, but like, we got the same thing going on.
Well, but for her, that's just an affectation, isn't it?
What? No, that's how they talk in Alaska, and that's how they talk here. We have the same settler groups. It's like, yeah, we really say that. We really do say that. So yeah, when everyone's going, oh my God, listen to how stupid she sounds, I'm like, oh yeah, well, you can go fuck yourself, don't you know?
Everybody's got something like that, though. It's, I mean, it's Southerners. People, I've had people tell me, I've gotten, like, turned down for auditions without even getting to read because they heard me speak my normal speaking voice. I've had jobs tell me, lose the accent and you might actually get somewhere in life. But then you've got people that have, like, a really distinctive Bronx or Boston accent. What was that stupid idiot that, of all the things that they could pick on about that god-awful interview or whatever, did they picked on the accent. I was like, oh, please. Everybody's got some type of accent or dialect. They're just too ethnocentric to realize that everybody else is making fun of theirs while they're making fun of somebody else's. And it's just really, it's, I mean, you know, come on, guys, get a hobby.
Yeah.
I think they're fun.
For an hour. And sit down and listen.
I confess I hate the sound of my own voice. I can't listen to voicemails if I recorded them. Oh, hell.
Most people like the sound of their own voice. I don't. Even the way I get around production is I just kind of tune out who's speaking and listen to either stuttering or raw information. So...
Nobody likes their own voice. It's
that's universal.
People that I did work with films that have been actors for 40 years, Pat Hingle did not like the sound of his own voice. It's just one of those things. You just decide, okay, screw it, I'm going to do it anyway.
I'd like to make a point about King of Pink Community.
Sure.
Please.
Dave's been on all of an hour and a half, and he said 3 weeks ago about how proud he was that we had a clean rating at PCB, and it only took us an hour and a half to ruin that.
Hey, there's a production, Peter.
that's the purpose of post-production. It really is.
Some people whose name I won't mention that every other word out of their mouth is fuck, shit, damn, bitch.
This is going to end up being a 9-minute podcast.
Hey, our live feed was never described as clean. It's only
published version.
Yes, only the published version, and that we put Kelly Mays over every expletive.
Actually, no,
is that...
Well, technically, I just take them out, so...
Speaking of that person, when is that ambush, I mean interview?
Next Wednesday.
Wow. Be sure to be there for that.
That should be interesting.
I am hoping that she just kind of sings us a Rickroll and everything will go smoothly. Somewhere in my head, but...
I played about the first 30 seconds of one of her videos on YouTube. That was, I confess, quite enough.
So I should not be there for that interview because then there won't be anything not beeped. Just checking.
Oh, no, you can be there. It's okay. I don't mind.
I should probably be there. I think I'm the only one who even sort of likes her music.
The only song that kind of gets stuck in my head, she keeps singing about ISIS, so I can't get past it. And that's a personal thing with me.
Only me, I'm a smooth jazz girl.
So, okay, I've got one thing I want to bring up, and we've talked about this before on other episodes, but one thing about wrecking a pagan community is, you know... Not planning for the future so that if one person has to step aside from leadership, the whole thing falls apart.
That's good. Allow for a contingency plan or something.
Mm-hmm. I hate to keep, again, I'm doing it again, coming back to a business medium, but to me, every time I've ever been an admin assistant or an office manager, I set the office up so that if I got hit by a bus, any idiot could come in there behind me and find everything.
I've done that before, Snooze, and I had someone call me and said that they hired someone who went in and deleted all of the step-by-step instructions I left.
Yeah, I've underestimated the level of idiocy that I was preparing for. I've done that too, but it's, you know, you got to start somewhere. And we've had people with the Grove that we've said, look, we've completely blown their mind because a good number of the people are accustomed to things being a little bit more structured like it would be in a traditional path type thing. And we're completely balls out in the alley, so we blow that all to crap anyway. But we've had people that have come up and we've said, listen, we want you guys to try running your own ritual. Put your own ritual on. Oh, well, we can't absurd you to the authorities. Like, honey, you ain't got no authority. We want you guys to step up and show your stuff, because not only does that accomplish that cross-training thing I was talking about earlier, where people appreciate what happens when they're in someone else's shoes, it gives us a day off. And now that we're taking some time off and going on hiatus for a while, we got this great guy and this fantastic chick that have stepped up, and they're going to be putting some stuff on. And two or three other people have taken other stuff that we started with and run with the ball. And it's brilliant.
The more that you're willing to step down and let somebody else take control while you're in a sort of head position, the more comfortable they will be taking over when it is necessary for them to do so. So instead of going, no, this is my job, you can't have it, you can't touch it, don't look at it, don't breathe on it, this is my job, I'm going to do it, the more that you let somebody else take the reins, whether it's leading a class, whether it's leading circle, or whether it's poor Dave leaving and leaving us with the recording.
Oh, yeah.
The more that you let them take the reins on something while you have a chance to correct them and go, okay, you guys, you know, this was okay, but do this next time, or did you think about doing this? The more confident they will be when you're not there to be able to give them that guidance.
Mm-hmm. And bloody darn it, I want a weekend off.
Yep.
You know, one thing about, you know, a way to not wreck a community, and it's something that I was talking to someone about, I don't recall who, about something I noticed at Pagan Spirit Gathering is that, you know, when I got there, one of the things that I really noticed is that everyone had agreed on how things should be and what the tone should be and how people should behave. And so to create that sort of common reality, everyone agreed to behave that way. And it was because everyone had sort of a clear idea from Circle Sanctuary's like guidelines and so forth, and from talking to other people and catching the tone of what the community should be. So if you're trying to create community, especially like local community, and you don't define what it is you're trying to do, I think like Miles was talking about, you know, if you don't have like a goal or a purpose, then it's going to fall apart anyways.
So it's a hangout group.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, you know, I get my cousin and I sort of get into it occasionally. He's a Southern Baptist minister. Because I tell him that a lot of the stuff that his youth group does is just social hangout stuff. They're not doing anything that regards religion. You know, he's doing these cool pizza parties, and they're doing slumber parties, and, you know, they're watching movies and everything. Well, where does the religion come in? You know, and where does the service and where does the spiritual work come in? And that if he's just providing them with a social group, then those people will fall away from his church.
I think you have an outlet for that, though, because it, like, okay, with our meetups, the meetups are just social events, but for a lot of people that come to them, it's the only couple of hours out of the week or out of the month that they can be around other people, that they don't have to police their speech, they don't have to watch what jewelry they wear, they don't have to be really, really kind of careful, or they don't wind up knowing that they're not going to find anyone to talk to about certain things that's going to appreciate or understand where they're at. And with any spiritual group that has just like a plain fellowship thing going on, it may not actually have a spiritual growth target to the event, but you're still spending time with people of like mind.
Mm-hmm.
I can endorse that.
Right. Yeah. And there's a time and place for social things, but you know, if your purpose is to create a spiritual community, if you're trying to create, you know, a temple or a coven or a grove, then if the main emphasis is social, then it's not going to have something really binding to hold it together. At least that's my perspective.
See, and I disagree with that. I think when you're doing social activities with a group, no matter what your main thing of your group is, that is exactly what builds community. Because when you're having a potluck, whether your group has to do with building model airplanes or your group has to deal with worship, the act of having a potluck and hanging out, that's exactly what builds a community.
Yeah, I get that. But like, if my coven was all about the feast and about the potluck part of it, that wouldn't interest me. I wouldn't be there. You know, there's a group in Atlanta that they once a month get together and they go to a pub together, and that's all they do. And for some of them, that's the only like, you know, pagan event that they go to, and that's enough for them. But, you know, it doesn't have, like, a cohesive whole, and it's not a really a strong community because it's just people who occasionally get together and go out to drink. And, you know, and that's my criticism with my cousin is that, you know, the main emphasis is on the social to the detriment of the spiritual. And yeah, maybe I'm putting all of this badly.
No. I see what you're talking about now. Is basically, it's one of those things of that it's not so much bad that they've got the variation in their activity or whatever. It's but their focus is getting, or their train, the actual focus is getting derailed, or the focus is not happening. So it's like, okay, what is your group produced? If the goal is just for fellowship and you guys have hung out 12 times in the past couple of months, mazel tov, you have achieved your goal. But if your goal is to have all of your people complete a, like, okay, for your relative, a catechism class from beginning to end, and nobody even cracked a book because they were too busy eating pizza, you know, fail. Did I get that right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so. Yeah. You know, because I remember when I was a kid that I went to church events where I was like, you know, I don't even understand what the whole point of this thing is. But then I'm a weird kid. I was always a weird kid. So, yeah, I am the odd Wiccan.
But see, that's part of it. If the group has a specific goal and they can have different activities that support that goal, that's one thing, they need to be clear on that. But the other thing is the attendees or the people who wish to take part in community need to understand what the goal is too and be on board with that. So for some people, say they go to that once a month thing and they go to the pub and drink, their goal and maybe the group's goal is to have people just meet each other. You're just getting out there in public and you're meeting each other and maybe you'll have a good conversation. And if that's what a person is looking for and that's what they're going for, this is a good community for them. That's a good thing that's going on. If a person is looking for people to engage in ritual with and they're expecting spiritual enlightenment or they're expecting a ritual to take place, then that's not a good community for them to be a part of.
Cricket.
Wow.
I think think everyone was just deeply contemplating the appreciation of that. That's my story. I'm sticking to it.
I didn't just want to say, yeah, that's a good point, and end there.
Uh-huh. Yeah, because, I mean, it's true, but it's true, but it still sounds kind of lame.
Yeah.
It's like, I have to come up with something meaningful, damn it!
Yay.
Space to technical stuff. We're moving secondary recording back to here and now.
Spell that.
C-L-L-A-R-U-U-A-G-H.
Excellent.
I live with Brandon. You learn very unique spellings.
So, you know, I know a lot of us work with not just, like, our local communities and stuff, but we kind of, you know, work with a very broader, an extremely broad definition of community. So what's the advice for working with very broad definitions of community, like, you know, the national pagan community or the North American pagan community, you know, or that sort of thing?
It may not be the right way to interact, but what I've always done is sit back and observe, especially if there's a lot of people that know each other and I am the new person to the group. Not sit back and be a complete wallflower and hide, but instead of opening up and saying my views right off and seeing how argumentative I can be and what waves I can create, sit back, see what the community's like, see how everything goes, test the waters a little bit, and slowly but surely open up a little bit more.
That's just being practical and being smart. It's a couple of different tribes that have the tradition of when, with Native Americans, when someone speaks, everyone waits for, like, 15, 20 seconds of silence to make sure that they actually got through with everything they were going to say instead of just jumping right in like, you know, all us hose heads would do. And it's not that no one can think of anything to say or that anybody's slow. It's just that they're actually wanting to wait and see what's going on before they jump in with their two cents,
mm-hmm.
which would probably drive all of us crazy. But it's, yeah, just sitting back and checking the weather and taking the temperature and everything is just being smart and being polite.
You know, one thing, and I kind of wish Kara was here for this one. She had to leave. But and we've sort of done it in this episode, which, you know, it happens. Is that, you know, one of the issues I run into a lot is when you're trying to speak to the pan-pagan community, to the larger umbrella community, that it's really difficult that a lot of times we tend to default to Wicca-centric language, and that isn't very inclusive. And, you know, and I do it. I still do it. I've done it on this episode where, you know, I default to talking about covens and high priestesses and circles and that sort of thing. But you know, I'm trying to be more aware of that and try to make an effort to be more inclusive. So.
Well, you know, they're speaking from what you know. And me, the smart thing there would be to go, okay, you're speaking from what you know. Let's tap somebody that can speak from what they know. That'll be a little bit of variety there.
I wonder if the problem is not being all inclusive, but as you're listening to somebody, like, yes, there is something to say with
respecting the fact that there are other people that practice different than you, and understanding that as you talk. But at the same time, I don't think there is a way that we could ever be all-inclusive, because we all experience things differently. So maybe part of it is when you speak, yes, understand that, but also when you listen. So instead of when Star says, well, the coven and the high priest, I'm not going to sit there and go, but Star, not all of us deal with covens, and I don't have priests, and I really don't appreciate you using those terms. You know, it doesn't need to be pagan politically correct.
It's a generalization.
Mm-hmm.
Like, gender he, or the male pronoun in an Hoshin book doesn't always mean that the only person who can use this thing is male. It's just a generalization for the ease of reference.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's something that people also kind of need to think about, is everybody out there does not have to speak for you on your terms. You can look at somebody, like you were just saying, use the example of a high priest and a high priestess and initiation, because that's what you know. That's where you're working from, and that's where you have your best examples and experiences from. Somebody, instead of saying, well, that also, da-da-da-da, why did they even bother with that? Somebody would nationally look at that way. Okay, the way that they do it, and in what I do, that would translate to such and such and whatever. And then if they're really, really on the ball, thinking about how that compares, not necessarily one's better than the other, but just what each one kind of covers and where each one goes. Kind of a way to appreciate instead of homogenous. Does that sound workable? Does that make sense? I'm getting kind of stupid here. Yeah.
You see the same problem when it, not problem, but you see the same issue when it comes to languages. Instead, people don't want to take the time to become, you know, polyglots and learn four or five different languages. They'd rather everybody else learn English or everybody else learn French.
Sorry. I did. I was just kidding.
No. Sorry, it threw me off. I was like, wait, I'm speaking in English. No.
There's a good story behind that one.
I'm sorry. No, we just derailed her. Come on.
That's funny.
My bad.
No, but it can also apply to how we look at how we're going to deal with each other. I have an associate, a Thelemite, who says, you know, Thelemite, he was talking about how he was sitting down with voodoo priests or something like that, and they were all just sitting down. And because at the end of the day, you're all just people. And he talked about how no matter the differences, you can still, if you know what you're talking about, you can still sit there and shoot the shit. You don't have to be into each other's thing. You don't have to be... you don't have to constantly curtail your language. And being PC, I respect what Star is talking about, that I think there can be a bent of Wicca-centered language that you do see. But I would also argue that that's how people perceive it more often than that's what it is. Because you're talking about, I don't think people have a malicious, you know, intent when they say something that might be Wicca or some other relatively more proliferous pagan path. I can't say much more on that than what I've already said, you know. Pagans need to get off their ass and learn about each other and stop bitching that nobody understands them or nobody makes things easy for them, because that's just life. Get over it, you know?
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, you know, the reason I bring it up and where it really came to my attention was when I was at PantheaCon, you know, there would be panels and people would ask a question relating to the pagan community in general, and they would get Wicca-specific answers. And I spoke to some Reconstructionists, and they told me, you know, that it was really frustrating to try to speak as if we are all a community, when the language that people tend to use when they're trying to be inclusive tends to exclude people who aren't Wiccan-esque.
But I think that jumps a step, though, Star. Before you can say they're attempting to exclude, you have to first confront them with what you think may be going on. I mean, if you received a Wicca-centered answer and you're a Reconstructionist, and say that to them, hey, I feel this answer doesn't apply to the question I'm asking, because I'm not asking for such and such related to Wicca, I'm asking about such and such B. I mean, if you jump straight to the exclusion without the confrontation part, then it's always going to perpetuate. And it might not be because they're trying to exclude you. It might be because of the, you know, myriad of reasons.
We ran into exactly that with Charlotte Pagan Pride Day. Miles was the co-coordinator, and I was the idiot that knew what was going on for the last 4 years. And, you know, we're on vacation from that now, too. We're taking a break. And we, every year, we would try to line people up for workshops and rituals and things, and everything we were getting was Wicca. And we would tell people, come, you know, we'd hear from people, Pagan Pride Day is just for Wiccans. It ignores the rest of us. It's completely, you know, exclusive. It's a waste of time. And I'm like, come do a ritual for us. Come do a workshop. You know, do a kids activity or something. Be there and do something. But, and I kept getting the, we shouldn't come because it's just for Wiccans. I'm like, well, it's only going to just be for Wiccans if you guys don't show up and do something. And then it won't just be for Wiccans anymore. So it was like we kept hitting this weird catch-22 thing going on. And part of that wasn't necessarily that they were just saying, well, it's just for Wiccans, we don't want to play. There was actually a feeling that they were intruding where they did not belong for some people. I mean, it covered a little bit of ground. But I wonder how much of that actually goes on with other festivals that would like to be more inclusive but are running into that.
To hell with them.
Well, no, seriously,
I genuinely mean that. If you're gonna get all butt hurt before you even attempt something or try to put your mark upon that festival, and you don't even step through that door, then stay away. To hell with you. If you're so damn scared and so damn or lazy or what, then go. Be afraid. Go sit in the corner somewhere.
Well, you know, at PantheaCon, there really was a lot of diversity in the workshops and the rituals offered, and there were a lot of Reconstructionists there. So I think that was one reason it surprised me to encounter Wicca-centric language so much there, because there was such a strong presence of Santeria and Voodoo and the different Reconstructionist faiths and heathens. So that was That's sort of what made that experience interesting, is for there to be such a large presence of other types of pagans, and yet still you ran into Wicca-centric language so often.
Has everyone defaulted to the chat room?
Well, should we do final thoughts?
Yeah, I'm just looking over. Did we miss anything?
I was looking over the outline, the program notes as well. We kind of glossed over a few of the talking points we had, but that's okay. I think we addressed anything worth addressing. So, yeah, final thoughts. Final tickets.
Final thoughts. Good night, everybody.
I think we have
final thought. I have a
hung around.
I have a final thought. Every once in a while, somebody types something that I think would make an awesome audio bite.
I know.
Okay, so make a list.
I think, though, that we agree that the best way to run or manage or be part of a successful and thriving pagan community is to be tolerant and agreeable and have some hubris. And the best way to ruin one is to be a self-centered argumentative butthead.
Or doormat.
Yes, actually, or a doormat. You let everybody walk all the crap over you, then the group won't accomplish anything. That's very true.
I think my final thought is that, you know, if you treat other people with respect, you respect their time and their boundaries and their experiences and their viewpoints, and you make it clear from the beginning that that's what the community is about respect, that you've got a really good chance to build a viable community. And without respect, it's really hard to do that.
Yay.
I think my final thought is, along with everybody else, and you know, you have to, everything we've already talked about, you have to have respect for other people as well as respect for yourself. But to remember that other people may not know that they are offending you, and that you need to let them know what is going on before you start foaming at the mouth, whether it is at them or other places, to give them a chance to either explain and or make a change. Don't just assume that they already know.
What about moderation in all things, including moderation? I used to have that on a beer cooler, foam beer cooler.
I like that.
Yeah.
I don't know who, that's one, I don't know who said that one either, but I gotta look that up.
The first part is Greek, the second part sounds like smartass, which I approve of.
That works. That works. Oh, that other quote is, that I was talking about earlier, I looked it up, so, I actually did find it this time, Robert Heinlein. I used a different search engine.
Yeah.
Yay. What was his book? He wrote a book that was influential.
Oh, he wrote tons of stuff.
He's it influenced
Stranger in a Strange Land.
Yes, that influenced Church of All Worlds.
Uh-huh. That's right.
That created Church of All Worlds.
He wrote tons of stuff. He wrote tons of stuff. But that's, yeah, that quote is fantastic. But either one of those will do. Did I get a cookie for that?
Yes.
Sure.
Excellent.
I give you a cookie.
Aww.
That was adorable.
She's good at those.
What? I used to get paid for that.
Just cheapy
make,
noises.
Yeah, make squeaking noises. Okay, that just came out all wrong. I'll explain that later.
Okay. Hey, Tom, I have an idea.
Oh, dear.
You might even think it's cool. I was suggesting to Scurvy that a
future podcast topic should be have Pagan Trivia Quiz Night. And I thought that the winning prize should be Star Foster's voice on your home answering machine.
Nobody wants that.
Hey, it works for NPR.
Yeah, exactly.
Nobody wants that. Now, if you could get, like, Selena Fox to do that, that would be so cool to have Selena.
We could get Peter to do it.
Yeah, we should have Peter.
Hey, Peter. Let's nominate him because he's not paying attention.
Oh, I'm paying attention. Yeah, I can see how that would go. Hi, this is Amber Roth.
Now, Dave isn't here, and Dave has a very distinctive voice, so I think it should be, hey, you've reached Amber of the Pagan Center podcast. See, Dave would be good at that.
We should do one for all of us.
Yeah, you should. You hear that, Dave? Voicemails for all of us.
That's for whoever wins the trivia night if we use that. Or just have voicemails for all of us anyway, just as a cool, like, Christmas gimme.
I know PCP once did Tom voices.
That way Scurvy could get hate voicemails.
Yay!
Peter needs a final thought in there.
Hmm?
Peter needs a final thought in there.
Yes, he does.
Yeah. Thank Peter.
All right. On topic, if you want to avoid wrecking a pagan community, listen three times as much as you talk.
I like Good. Him.
I like that.
Score.
Let's get some off-topic final thought here.
I like Pop-Tarts.
Ow!
So we've gone from rock love to Pop-Tarts?
You stole it, you boogerhead.
Yeah, they're fun. They have this soft, squishy filling. Never mind.
My off-topic final thought is I was glad I was able to slide slavery in there somewhere, since that has become Dave's new tradition to relate things to slavery, even though they don't have anything to do with it.
That's like
Dave-ism.
That's like a subcategory of Godwin, isn't it? Like Bonner's corollary or somebody like that. Yeah.
Dave's trying hard to make it.
Right.
Wow.
So we should actually start referring to it as Grega's. Yeah, okay. Grega's Law.
Just read with that last name, please.
Hmm?
That's what the bleep button's for.
Yeah.
See?
I've been listening to this podcast, and I realize how good we actually are with the bleep button. Trust me.
Yes.
Okay, I didn't figure that was going to be an issue because everybody's name comes up on their chat window when it rotates out. And I thought you guys like video these. Do you blitz those out too?
No.
Okay.
That's why I really wasn't worried about it.
Okay,
he also
cool.
posts on the podcast and his name's up there, so.
Okay, notes to self. I mean, No, that's not... I'm a newbie. I'm not going to, you know, tell me when I screw up. Because I'm all... I got some mop now, because I do that a lot. I got practice. I burn calories doing that.
Well, you could do like I did, just like pick a nickname, but something happens when you do that.
You were just low on citrus.
Hmm. I've been using snooze for years as a nickname, and the number of people that get their knickers all in a wad because, you need to be right front. You need to use your real name. It's like, okay, I know 3 6-packs of Heathers, and I will not be confused with 3 of them. It's like, okay, guys, it's not a magical name. It's not a circle name. It's a nickname. They still have those. They still make them. The expiration date on mine has not run out. So, I mean, you know, I use it.
Unfortunately, I really am Star. It's not a, yeah.
I think that's like cool.
That's perfectly workable.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I had a class in like elementary school where, I kid you not, we actually had 6 different girls with variations on the name Christy, Christine, or Crystal.
Yeah.
Perfectly good names, but can we have some variety, please? I think that's perfectly good.
Well, be afraid. 4 generations from now, you're going to get a whole bunch of other freaking names. Like, you know, somebody's going to name their child like Moonbeam. And then it's like, it won't be the cool Star.
It's even worse than that. I already know 2 people that have named their infant daughters Bella.
And it was
like Voldemort.
And it was reported that after...
I can respect that, damn it.
Sure. And it was reported that after the uprising in Egypt, someone named his daughter Facebook.
Ooh.
Because the whole evolution in Egypt was propelled by mass Facebook communication.
Well, she can just always call herself Face when she gets older. I mean, it worked for Dirk Benedict.
Oh, good grief.
Yeah. Wow.
At least it has meaning. Hey, but at least it has meaning, though. I mean, big, important meaning. I mean, like, whereas some parents, it's so pathetic. They do bibliomancy on a baby name book. You know, it's like, pop it open. Your name shall be Karen. Yeah.
But we're going to spell it really funny, so you have to explain it to every single person you meet for the rest of your life.
Well, I pulled a good one with a good friend of mine. He was my last name's Moody. So the joke went, oh, if you're Moody, that means your mom's a Moody mother.
What's the joke about the, you know, the little Indian boy goes to one of the elders and says, you know, grandfather, how do Indians get their names? And he tells him, you know, when the child is born and has his first cry, the father will look out the door of the tent, and the first thing he sees that nature gives him is the child's name. Why do you ask? Dog's fucking.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. I'm not the only person that's heard that one, am I?
No, I've heard that one.
Yeah. You want a real Indian name story?
Hmm.
So I got started on this whole path at Hopi, and I was studying with these people, and anybody knows anything about them, they're very quiet people and very mellow, and they don't teach you a whole lot because there's a lot of stuff that's clan-related they can't teach you.
Mm-hmm.
But my little white mind, they invited me up there because my hobby was clowning and I do parties for the kids and stuff. And my little white mind was like, oh, you know, I need an Indian name. I need an Indian name. So this guy I was studying with always kind of put me off. And finally broke down. Okay, we'll do a ceremony and give you an Indian name. And it was really cool. They had like Hopi Koshiers come in, which are one of the Kachinas and stuff. And just because of my clowning background. And he says, your Indian name is Quiet Bear. And I knew better where I was sitting than to ask why that name. But, you know, I knew it had to have a deep meaning. And later on, I asked Al Savapu, the guy who gave me the name, you know, why the name Quiet Bear? And he looked at me and said, wishful thinking.
Nice.
That is awesome.
Oh my God, it took me 2 seconds to get it. I was like, I don't wait. Oh.
We wound up with one that's like a cultural pretzel thing. It's part of the side of the family that's Cherokee. I've got Cherokee and Tuscarora. And one of the Cherokee ancestors married an Englishman whose last name was Silverthorn, which that's not a horribly uncommon, you know, English name. But they there's a lot of people that when we were going back and doing some family research and other people that I've talked to that have automatically heard Silverthorn and said, oh, yes, you know, this is Native American name. And it's like, no, actually, it was English. Her Native American name was, you know, was Antler. And they're like, oh, yeah, Antler Silverthorn. This isn't, no, she didn't have a surname. Her name was Antler. She took Silverthorn as his last name. It doesn't have a darn thing to do with Native American. And they don't believe it. They think that because it sounds like something from the natural world and it's two words strung together, that it must be a Native American name, in spite of the fact that everybody knows that any name that starts off with silver and then has something after or whatever's got to be Wiccan.
Wow.
Oh, I didn't say that. I'm a real big, real, real big, big, big Pixie Moondrip name, pagan name generator fan, okay? I'm sorry.
I really like the, I don't think it's on anymore, the pagan name generator in which it completely randomly gives you the name of, let's see, the name of a metal, the name of a bird, and the name of an animal.
Oh, that was so much fun. I remember that.
That was great, and that was, it was based on, it was inspired by you know who, but we tried that, and I got the name, and I think it is wonderful. The name that thing gave me was Aluminum Stork Donkey. I love stork donkey. Even sounds good. You're a stork donkey.
You're a stork donkey. Mom, he's being a stork donkey.
My ex-husband couldn't pronounce aluminum to save his life. I don't know why. The word just gave him trouble. And so he would always be like, while you're at the store, you need to pick up some aluminum. And he put a loony in the middle of it. Yeah. Hand me a sheet of aluminum. Aluminum. It was funny.
In England, aluminum is known as aluminium. And for years, I could not say aluminum. I had to say aluminium. And of course, now I work in a metal shop, and so I'm using aluminum all the time. I had to learn how to say the word to work in this job. I kept on trying to say aluminium, and they always look at me funny. I had to retrain.
That's the way it's supposed to be said. It's supposed to be aluminium. Damn what? Americans, I blame you all.
Okay.
They mess everything up. Drive on the wrong side of the road, all that cheese.
Oh, just shut up and take your vitamins.
I like my vitamins.
It's not the right time for his schedule.
Thank you. I was going to say schedule and you beat me to it.
Schedule, that's right. Schedule.
I can't, don't look at me. I can't be arsed.
What's that?
From Peter Diving. Blah, blah, blah. Too scurvy. Blah, 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 blah. Signed by, now like it says, important mainly because of the people in the conversation. I got flagged right up there in my priority inbox and everything.
So what's it say?
Feel better now?
Yeah, what's the subject line?
Hate mail.
You got some hate mail. Yay.
You want to know what my favorite piece of hate mail is?
What?
Out of all the hate mail I have gotten, this is my favorite. I posted a Matchbox 20 video to Facebook. Because I haven't heard the song in a long time. I was like, oh yeah, this is an awesome song. And someone sent me, like, the most horrible hate mail on Facebook and then defriended me.
Oh.
And I was just like, of all the things to get angry at me over,
on Matchbox 20...
Wow.
That's how it usually works, though. Nobody gets mad at the stuff, the stupid no-brainer bullshit that you do that deserves to be mad at, you know, in Clue by Ford. They get mad at stupid stuff like I wore blue socks with the wrong color shoes and totally socially unacceptable crap like that. This is one of the reasons why I like my dogs. Well, my dogs make sense.
Yeah.
They don't care.
Right.
Well, as much as I would like to hang out and provide witty commentary for after hours, I think I am going to hit the sack, guys.
Christ, but it's like 20 after 11.
It is close.
Yeah.
We still got to blow the cat.
We do have to blow the cat. Yes. Yes, we do.
I got that what? Recorded. Now I'm happy.
You're welcome.
All right. Well, night, guys.
Night, Star.
Night, night, Star.
Hi, guys. Winnie, Winnie, summer.
Good night, Star.
I'll see you later, Pig. I gotta go now.
Night, night.
Yeah, I do have to get off here, though. Like I said, we still got to give Nimbus his meds, which is an adventure in itself. And you have to get up at 5:30 in the morning, young man.
I know I do. That is true.
Well, thank you so much for the topic, Miles.
You're welcome. Actually, it was fun to do. I really, if there was a way to do so, I would like to re-record my introductory monologue, because I think it sounded like crap all. But I was in my bad voice.
I think there should be a way to record it, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or to re-record it, or just to seriously edit what's there.
Scurvy, you have a way to, like, up the time?
Like, if I do something now, can you paste that in over the previous...
If you wanted to do that, Audacity...
No, but I got AVS.
I beg your pardon, young man. What, no.
I can do audio. I can do just audio with AVS.
Yep, just drop me the MP3.
I'll show you how to do it tomorrow when you get home from work.
If you want to.
It's not hard. Okay. It's the same one that I used to do the Agora thing and the chocolate cover transformer thing and Nimbus's. Which admittedly aren't that great, but that's just because I couldn't be honest.
And your Yes, I'm a Witch video.
Yeah, and yeah, that was pathetic too, but...
Oh, that was good.
Well, I'm still getting the hang of it, and I got a shitty camera, and I couldn't be arsed. I'm going to be saying that for a couple of days now.
Arsed.
It's your fault. I'll show you how to do it when you get home from work tomorrow.
All right.
Everybody have a most fantastical and most excellent evening.
I take the very same. I'm not,
It's so cute when he does that. It's not of the voice. It's the whole higher language and the whole evocation goes along with it too.
Well, I had to do the voice for 2 years. I may as well get something out of it.
Yep.
Yeah. So,
you know. I used to work for Coastal ADR in Wilmington. At the film studio, they do automatic
overdubbing.
Yeah, it's automatic dialogue replacement, and they do they get Japanese anime and Japanese films and dub the English voices in. But they have quite a few characters. You know what a chibi is?
Mm-hmm.
Well, me and two other buddies of mine that went in and did stuff and everything were the combination, like, we were the chibi team and the sex noise team. And the chibis are just, you know, just random weird vocalizations that don't mean anything. But they're all over the place because they get these little monster characters, and there's no dialogue in the packet. You're just supposed to make stuff up because it's all the Japanese actor did. We had that, and then we also did the crowd noises, which we call the sex noise crowd crew, because you're doing crowd reaction, so every noise you make is, and you have to make it sound like six different people. So I did chibis for like 2 years for Coastal ADR for a couple of video projects and stuff, so it's like, damn it, I worked on it, I'm going to get my mileage out of it.
That's cool.
Oh, it was a blast. I had fun doing it. Especially since I didn't have to pull any lines. I just make stupid noises. All right. I'm going to go get your son ready for his drugs. Everybody have a most fantastical evening.
All right. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good night.
Me too. Good night.
Bye-bye.
Hey, you guys want to hear something weird? Sure.
Wait, are you guys still recording?